It's good. Hello, I'm Jack Rickard. This is EVTV, Electric Vehicle Television. And this is my long-suffering co-hostage, Consigliere El Brano Noto.
It's good to be here. It's the third day of spring, and it's rotten.
We're having a colder spring than we had a winter.
I know, it's terrible. It's absolutely terrible.
Oh, well. Had a good week this week.
You did.
Things are coming along, coming together. Klumpenberg has taken on an investor, and we're shipping him a big wad of batteries. He's going to be, it turns out, Kalb doesn't really have a warehouse in Europe.
I didn't know that.
But no. EVTV does EVTV. Now.
But we do.
We're going to have the largest stash of CA cells in Europe. And so if you order them from Kalb, it's 12 weeks. And if you order them from Anna, I think you have them on a truck the next morning.
Yeah, that many cells. Wow. That's going to be cool.
What do you know in the news?
Oh, yeah, there's just stuff everywhere.
Stuff. I love stuff.
What can we talk about? I mean, I hate to always talk about Tesla, but I guess why not? They're doing stuff. They're selling cars. They're, half of their stock is shorted. I mean, Elon Musk is out there talking about on the TED Talks and things. But the latest thing they've been talking about is the long tailpipe.
Mm-hmm.
And the myth of the long tailpipe. And Elon did a TED Talk, which I'm sure any of you can find on the TED website. God knows how long it is. Not the long tailpipe myth. Well, J.B. Straubel's out there now, too,
mm-hmm.
Talking about it. He did an interview with SAE with their magazine. Just talking about it's still better to mass produce electricity than to make gasoline. And what about solar? Why don't we charge our cars on solar?
This is straining at gnats, Brian. There is a whole discussion to be had, and it's not very interesting to me.
Yeah, I know.
You can pile what ifs and wherefores in a series stack so long you can't charge them. It's a constant game of one-upmanship. Oh, but I know something you don't know. If you take it back to when the sun was born, it's there's a basic misunderstanding. There's two things why I don't care. Where the electricity comes from. Electricity is not an energy source. It is an energy medium, and it is our most fungible form of energy in that it's the most easy to translate into other things like work.
Yeah, right.
But it can come from anywhere. It can come from other electricity. It can come from people riding a bicycle with a generator on the back.
Didn't they do that on Gilligan?
Firewood, yes. Gilligan and the professor made coconut batteries. it can come from wind. It can come from sun. Our first power plants came from Niagara Falls.
Yeah, right.
Our first large-scale power plants came from Niagara Falls, from hydro. And so whether you get it from charcoal briquettes or whatever, I don't care. And it's changing anyway. That's a whole other policy matter. For the electric car or for automobiles, it's really simple. The electric car is 4 to 5 times over the car more efficient at converting energy into forward motion. A gasoline car mostly converts gasoline into heat and blows it out through the front of the car. The actual process of movement is a side effect.
Yeah, you're just lucky it moves.
Right, and it's 11 or 12% efficient and we're 60-70% efficient. And so a gallon of gasoline has nominally 33 kilowatt hours in it. And if I haul around 1,700 pounds of batteries, I can hold about 2 gallons worth.
Right, 2 gallons worth. Exactly.
But I can drive 100 miles in an 8,000 pound vehicle. It's a lot more efficient. Where you get the electricity is further not of interest to me, in that what they're not counting at all is the electricity they're not using to produce the gasoline.
Exactly. Yeah.
As it turns out, it takes about 7.5 kilowatt hours of electricity to make a gallon of gasoline.
Yeah, there goes all your savings.
And guess where they get most of it?
Most electricity to produce gasoline?
Mm-hmm.
No, I don't know.
Well, they get it primarily, I would say 80% or more, from non-retail electricity sources. In other words, they make their own electricity. And guess what? The oil companies use to make electricity 100%.
Coal?
Yeah.
They use coal.
Oh, place the swimming in oil, but they use coal. Why do they use coal? Because it's the least expensive thing. So they point at the percentage of our total electricity that is made from coal.
Yeah.
That's not true of the total retail electricity, because that's a lower number.
Yeah, you're not looking at everything.
It's 58% of the total electricity. It's 47% of the retail electricity. Electricity that's sold by utility companies. Industry makes a lot of its own electricity. The largest producer of electricity in industry is the oil industry. They're virtually 100% coal. And then they tell you that your electricity is coming. Their electricity is coming from coal. If you take the 7.5 kilowatt hours from a gallon of gasoline, in any of our small cars, that's about 30 miles of travel.
Right. Yeah.
Which is how far I would go on a gallon of gasoline.
Right. Exactly.
In a really efficient small car. In our big cars, it's about 8 or 9 miles, which is what I get in town from a gallon of gasoline in an Escalade.
Right. That's about it.
Why don't you give me the electricity you're using to make the gasoline? The utility industry doesn't have to produce anything, and you can keep the gallon of gasoline and still sell it to China.
Sell it to somebody.
So I'm not real keen on what I consider a moronic conversation among sort of like a battle between the super green and the oil company hacks about nonsense. It's not close. It's a dramatic decrease, even given their assumptions in CO2. It's a dramatically less expensive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's dramatically better for us in all respects, given some moronic assumptions that don't even apply. So I don't really want to get caught up in that conversation. The car itself runs better on electricity. Electricity is a medium, not a source. You can get the energy to make the electricity from blowing into your hat for all I care.
That's right.
Methane.
Yeah, that's right.
Too many bratwursts. That's methane. Right. That cows. Works fine for me.
Yeah, cows.
T. Boone Pickens, we ought to use natural gas. I'm with you, baby. Run it through a power plant and mail it to me.
Right.
Over the wires. We have the infrastructure to distribute the electricity now.
Right.
See, most alternative energy vehicles require some additional infrastructure. We could use some, but as we have diagrammed on this show, much ado about nothing. To put a fast charge station every 50 miles across our entire interstate highway system.
Yeah, right. We have talked about this.
Is 1,150 locations. 1,150. It would cost over $100 million.
Right.
Which is lost in the rounding errors of anything done in America now.
Oh, right, right. Anything that we're doing
here. Apple's got $140 billion in the bank.
That's right, cash.
They could do it and not even know why they did it.
No.
And it wouldn't matter.
Just so we wouldn't have to go to the Apple.
Much less the federal government or anybody else. These are not problems. I mean, I don't want to spend any time on them. They're not problems.
No.
Why they had J.B. Straubel at the SAE thing was very interesting. They're afraid. There's a battle. We've diagrammed between Chedimo and SAE, J1772 Rev B, October 2012, which is their DC charging standard.
Right.
Now, here's what a JB has to say about that. They're talking 120 amps at 400 volts.
That's pretty.
It's not enough power.
No, not for a car like that. Yeah.
If you have a 20 kilowatt car,
yeah, you have a battery pack that
you can barely get it charged in 30 minutes.
Right.
And JB's got an 85 kilowatt our car now,
right. And
looking down the road, if you're going to set a standard, it should be something that's viable for 5 or 10 years. What will be the size of the energy storage in an electric car in 10 years?
You would assume that it would be greater than today.
I would assume 150 or 200 kilowatts.
Right. Yeah.
What are you doing with a 125 amp fast charge standard?
Right.
This is stupid.
Yeah, it's kooky.
It's ugly.
Yes.
But that's not the problem.
No.
The problem is this standard's stillborn.
Right.
It doesn't do as much power as the Chedimo now.
No.
And the Chedimo does not do enough.
No. And in fact, I think one of Straubel's suggestions was not to worry about the car side of the standard, but to worry about the port side.
Which is where to worry.
Right.
How many times have I said this? These batteries have been able to charge at 3C the whole time we've been working with them.
Right. Yeah. Has there been
3C means three times the capacity in current, which implicitly is 20 minutes.
Yeah, right.
The cars, the batteries can charge in 20 minutes. And always have been able to. Where have you got that much power? Show me where I can plug in and charge a 30 kilowatt pack at a 90 kilowatt rate.
Right.
You got to be able to squirt 90 kilowatts. That's the amount of power we use to power all of South Cape Girardeau.
Yeah.
The problem with fast charge, which is a serious enabler,
yes, it is,
of electric cars, because it allows you to take trips. I don't want to take a trip in an electric car, but God love it. I think you ought to be able to.
Right,
if you want,
yeah,
to. And as I say, 1,150 charge stations, you're done. There's no place you can go on an interstate highway system and be more than 50 miles from a charge station.
Right.
At 1,150 locations. For Nissans and General Motors and even Teslas, they could form a consortium to just go build these things. But a lot of places where they're building them, they can't get 90 kilowatts of power.
That's true. Yeah, where are you going to get it out in the middle of
the middle of nowhere? Ergo, Solar City and the concept of solar.
Right.
Charging stations. And I love it. I like solar. I'm not worried about solar. I'm not worried about coal. And the other point that Straubel was making Duh. I don't need this. Should we even talk about this? Our viewers already know this. A little three-cylinder hybrid engine. Wolf Creek Nuclear Power Plant. It's much easier to make things more efficient in a stationary, large-scale system. Right. You get 12% in your car. I can build a power plant that'll do 60%. Or better, if that's my mission. Because they got all the room in the world for equipment.
Yeah, right.
We can run that heat around in a circle until it's cold. Right?
Right.
This is not, this is a mature technology.
Yeah.
There's no way you can put a power plant in a car that can approach the efficiencies you can get on a large scale in a fixed location. Yeah. Now, come on. Everybody knows this, right? We don't need, we're not going to explain this. It's silly talk, but his point, well taken, with SAE is, what are you doing? 120 amps, 400 or 500 volts.
Yeah, but not enough today.
Yeah, it's not enough now.
It's not enough today.
You can't charge one of JB's cars right now.
No.
In an hour.
No, not like that. Too big of a pack.
Why would he adopt a standard
that's already DOA?
That's DOA.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't think it's ever going to hardly see the light of day. What else about Tesla?
Well, one interesting thing, there is now an aftermarket for some Tesla parts.
A sure sign of success.
Yeah, the Tesla accessories.
Mm-hmm.
And they have just one product,
mm-hmm.
and it is a center console that will hold a champagne glass, if you'd like.
They never did decide what to put in the center console.
No, they never
so
did.
This guy's come up with a center console with a coffee cup holder.
Coffee cup.
That's a brilliant move, but no, it's a sign of success.
Yeah, it is.
But
yeah.
Actually, there's going to be a teeming market. I believe you're going to be able to develop software for that Tesla operating system, and that could be interesting. Tesla, meanwhile, now claims they are making 500 cars per week.
Yes, yes.
Guess who I got a call from yesterday?
Who?
A Tesloid. Actually, a Tesloidette.
Really?
Yes, young lady, very pleasant voice, very professional sounding, very nice, not pushy. But she noted that I had had a reservation for some time, that I had canceled it, and noting that on the off chance that I might have changed my mind, they would reinstate me, yes, and get me a car.
Really?
And this is, as I predicted, they didn't do the refunds. They simply did not refund the deposits of people canceling reservations until after the first of the year. That allowed them to make certain claims about their number of reservations.
Right.
Well, now it's first quarter, and all those come home to roost.
Yeah, right. They've got to put them, take them off the books now.
Right. And yeah. So, ergo the call.
Interesting.
If I could, if you could get J.B. Straubel to come talk at EVCON,
I'll
buy their stupid car, which is overpriced.
All right. Then you heard it first.
Yeah, there you go.
Let's see, what else? You know, the EV making noise thing has kind of, I think that the NHTSA has had some hearings and things like that,
mm-hmm.
You know, about the noisemakers. The curious part of all that was, I didn't know what cars made noises already
mm-hmm.
and how they dealt with them. So there's no rule right now, but apparently the Nissan Leaf plays a sound of moving less than 18 miles an hour.
Mm-hmm.
Used to be a button to deactivate it, but they got rid of it. So
mm-hmm.
The Volt has a warning sign, but you do it yourself.
Mm-hmm.
The Toyota, the Honda, the Mitsubishi all do, and it can't be turned off. And the Model S does not play a warning sound.
Hmm.
So, God knows.
They're trying to get the 2014 go-live date to go to 2016,
yeah.
and let's talk about it.
Yeah.
The problem is Congress passed this absolutely moronic law that electric vehicles have a sound device.
They do.
Dumb country boy. I'm thinking, how about the horn?
Yeah. Well, and how annoying. And the manufacturers are really having a hard time.
The button in the middle of the steering wheel for anyway?
Yeah. And the manufacturers have kind of an interesting argument. It's like now they put this crazy thing on electric cars that we're trying to get adopted.
Uh-huh.
To make a stupid sound.
You have to have a device on a car already to make a stupid sound.
Yeah.
And it is mandated.
Yeah, it's already mandated. And they
go get a safety inspection without a horn, see what happens.
You cannot.
Your automobile in the United States of America, all 50 states, you have to have an operating horn to license the car.
Yes.
A noise-making device.
Yes.
Now, what they want is for it to make some sort of car noise at certain speeds. Have these people ever been around a car? Do they have cars in Washington, D.C.? How do they get around there?
They might ride buses, public transportation.
Hey, pull up in a 2013 Lexus at less than 12 miles an hour and record that for me and play it back on YouTube.
Yeah, you won't hear very much.
You don't hear shit.
Yeah. No, you don't.
It doesn't make any noise at all at 12 miles an hour.
Cars have gotten very quiet. Yeah, cars have gotten quiet. And even,
but it still has a horn.
Still has a horn, and they're even going to get quieter.
another conversation I just don't get.
Yeah, it's absolutely.
You're required to have a noisemaker, and you do have.
Yeah, well, and you also have another noisemaker, your tires. You know, tires make a lot of noise, and in fact, the BMW is on their new i3.
Brian, I was on an aircraft carrier for 44 months. I can't hear a 429 big block, right?
You can't hear anything anyway.
So this is all a little lost on me. What you want to do is listen to F4 16 hours a day for about 4 years.
When you're tired of hearing them, you can't hear.
Let me give them a little bell. Ching, 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 ching. All right, how about this? I propose this. Anytime the car is in motion at under 12 miles an hour, it plays a Basil Poledouris theme from Lonesome Dove. Every time I walk into a room, it plays that, doesn't it? Then you should all have to hear it every day of your life like I do. It gets to you after a while. It's pretty music, but not every time you walk into a room. Criminy.
I love it. And on the tire noise, which I think is actually pretty cool, the BMW has actually driven some interesting movement with tire manufacturers in Europe. You know, tires, and we went from really thick wide walls, and we use them like on the Mini Cooper, real thin wide wall sidewalls. Mm-hmm. They've gone from 16 inches to 21 inches tires, and are still moving. What they did was made them wider and gave them more of a contact patch. Now they're starting to make them narrower, so they're more, a little more
beautiful. www.mossmotors.com. What you want is BMW is a tire for a 1947 MGTC. This has already been worked out. I've got one. Don't ask me how I know. They're this wide. They're 21 inches. Lots of spokes, which makes them light. A very low unsprung wheel mass. They had all this worked out in the 40s, actually the 30s. And nothing's changed. We were able, in our gluttonous capacity, to consume very inexpensive fuel to do away with all that and get shorter, fatter, softer tires, and all good. But it's real easy. Go to Moss Motors, and you can order these.
I got one last thing. I'm as far as from the news side anyway, and then we'll move on. Last week we talked about the horrific a death toll of 8,000 pigs that had washed.
I've been haunted by that since last Friday.
Had a tough time sleeping.
The specter of pig wars or
something. Jumping to their
death. Chinese pigs, worse. I just can't fathom it. The loss of life.
Loss of porcine life.
Yes, it's haunting.
Well, I've got more bad news. It's double. It's up to 16,000.
Oh, my God. It gets worse.
It gets worse.
Making bacon.
I guess now they've kind of narrowed it down. Just every pig farmer upriver Shanghai is just tossing pigs in the river, and they can't stop them.
Do I understand this correctly? They think our tea party is something, huh?
Yes, exactly.
Apparently, they have diseased pigs.
Yes.
That's why you cook them well.
That's right. Don't want to get one.
Apparently. Do I get this right? The government over there jailed the guy for life for selling known diseased pigs.
There's more than one.
They got him. They made an example of him.
They made an example and took a couple of more, too.
What have all the farmers done?
They just tossed the pigs. Just killed the pigs. It's, out of the pig farming business.
It's a continental, massive pig sacrifice.
That's right. There you go.
It's a pig protest. They're protesting the pigs.
It's a porcine porker protest pot.
That's right. So the farmers, not wanting to go to jail, of course, but also, I'm sure, enraged at this goofy thing. The farmer doesn't know if the pig's sick or not.
Right. Yeah.
Put a guy in jail for life for pig purveying?
Yes. Yes.
Pork purveyance?
Three men sentenced to life in prison last November for procuring dead pigs to sell their meat.
So they're just,
my pigs are kind of...
They're just going down to the river, cutting them little bastards' throat, and tossing them in the river. Here, you handle this, pig.
That's right. It's a
piggy
protest.
That's a piggy protest. Ain't catching me with no pig. I ain't going to jail.
I'm divesting myself of all my pig holdings.
Yes, we are divesting ourselves of our entire pig operation.
We're out, man. We're out of
It's not worth going to the big house over a few pounds of bacon and some ham hock. 16,000.
Yeah, I think they're up to sit double next to the, in a week. Yikes. There goes the Mushu pork.
No kidding. No kidding. What are you going to eat in Hong Kong now?
Yeah,
chicken.
Chicken. That's all I've got.
The thing thing.
The thing thing. All right.
Jeff Southern sent me an update on his thing in Kennesaw, Georgia.
Oh, cool.
I like. Let's take a look.
All right.
Hello, Jeff Southern here. Thought I'd give you an update on my thing project. Been working on it since June of last year, so a little over 9 months, I guess, into it. Suppose I should have given birth to a working electrical Volkswagen thing by now. Anyway, just want to give you a quick update. The first thing that I'm going to show you is a fitting I made at the rear of the car. It's actually for the brake pressure transducer for the Curtis controller. So here's that video. Well, here you can see the finished adapter. This back hole back here is 1/8 MPT. You got a 10 millimeter port here, 10 millimeter here, and 10 millimeter here. This is the original T piece in the rear. This is for the brake line. This is a mounting hole. And what I did is I made the unit so that the mounting hole is roughly in the same, so that this port on this side will be in the same orientation relative to the hole. It's important because this hard line goes across the transmission over to the other side, and it would probably be hard to move that. I did move this port here a little bit offset from the original T. It's not a problem because the main brake line that comes from the front to the rear of the car has got actually a little bit of slack in it. And then this port won't matter, the extra half an inch or so won't matter at all because this one is a soft line. So this is actually a soft line. And then the port will be screwed into the back.
I made the part with 1/8 amputee. The sensor that I bought from EVTV actually has a quarter inch amputee on it. So I bought this adapter from Parker Hannah. See if I can get it with the right hand instead of my left hand. There it goes. So that'll be the way it'll work. And then I'm going to use this to thread into here. So that's the way my brake adapter will work. And the nice thing is this will be mounted to the rear, so this will be very close to the Curtis controller. That way you won't get much noise interference between running it from the front all the way to the back, so you don't have to worry about that. If you have one of the new brake sensors from EVTV, all you'd have to do is screw it directly into this block. I am going to put some thread sealer in here. It's commonly not used in brake lines, but Loctite and Permatex both make a special sealant material for these things. They'll handle up to 10,000 PSI once it fully cures after 24 hours. It's heat resistant and it's brake fluid, hydraulic fluid resistant. So I'm probably going to put a few drops on here and a few drops on here when I finally do the assembly.
Well, here's a shot of it with the pressure reducer installed. This is the main swing axle here. You can see the shock there in the background. So this part does pivot, but there's no way it's going to come up high enough to interfere with the sensor. Kind of get a little better angle of it from right in there. So yeah, you can see how it works. So I think this will be nice. The pressure transducer will be in the rear of the car and closer to the Curtis controller for less interference.
Okay, now I'm going to show you kind of the most up-to-date status of the car. So here it goes.
I think I'm kind of going to do a walk around of where things stand right at the moment. I have actually got the car painted. Painted the body, sanded it down. This is not what you'd call a show quality paint job. It's probably more of a 5-foot paint job, which means it'll look good from 5 feet. It is nice and shiny. There's still a few imperfections. I didn't completely strip the paint down to the metal. So it's gonna look pretty good, but not quite show car. I did get some nice wheels. These are Porsche 356 wheels with Michelin Energy Series tires on them. The size I chose was the one that most closely matched the original tires. It's a 15-inch tire. I do have disc brakes on the car now. So I put front disc brakes on it, left rear drums. Have completely rebuilt the suspension of the car. All new bushings, bearings, things of that nature. So mostly what I've done so far is really just about restoring an old car. Very little of it has been dedicated toward just an electric portion of the car. However, back here in the back, you can see I do have the motor mounted. It is mounted with a standard plate with a flywheel. I bought the adapter from Thunderstruck Motors. This is my Curtis controller. It's going to mount in the middle. Haven't got it completely mounted yet, but as you can see, it'll be a nice mount because the motor leads will just come from here to here, here to here, and here to there. So it'll be a nice short route. Using gland nuts for everything. This is a cable that will come up to the most negative part of the pack and it'll simply connect right here. So it'll be a nice clean connection. This one will tie the rear battery packs to the front battery pack. And the smaller one, which is actually only a 2-aug cable, will actually connect to the most positive portion of the pack in the back so that I can get the most positive portion up to the front of the car. One thing Jack likes to do is water cool. I'm not a real big fan of water cooling on something like this, so I went with a massive heat sink. This is a 10-inch by 10-inch by 2-inch heat sink with a 3/8 plate in it. So it's 3/8 aluminum at the bottom, it's 2 inches tall, and it's 10 by 10, and I went ahead and inserted a fan in the middle of it as well. And I'm going to have a thermocouple hooked up to it so that I'll actually know what the case temperature of the heat sink is, and I'll kick the fan on probably somewhere around 120 degrees, whatever is appropriate. That'll be wired up to the PLC in the front of the car that controls everything. What I have in the back are two battery packs. They're covered up with a little bit of plastic now because I'm still working on the back here and I don't want to get metal chips and stuff down in my battery pack. But there's 10 cells in this side saddle pack and 10 in this one, so I'm going to have 20 cells in the rear. This is where the original wiring harness comes through the firewall. Obviously, there'll be some bushings up there to clean that up. So that's kind of what's happening at the rear of the car back here. Where the cables come through, what I did is I just took some PVC pipe and taped it up so that it would fit in the middle of the heater element. This is where the heat from the rear of the car used to come through on the passenger side. And what this will do, and then I just sprayed expanding foam in here so it filled up with expanding foam, so I got a nice way of bringing the cables through the car with a nice weather seal on it. The cables come through nicely, bend over, and run up the side of the tunnel. In the original thing, there used to be a sheet metal cover in this area right here that covered up the heater tubes that carried up the heat up to the front. Since I'm going to actually have a resistance heater in the car, I don't need those. But I'm going to make a shield to go over these cables. The shield will serve basically three purposes. It'll protect the cables. It'll prevent anybody from getting burned if there were to be an arc flash where the cable shorted out on the side of the car. And it'll also provide an EMI shield. This is the original wiring harness that run through the thing. They do run it on the side of the tunnel just like this. So that's the wiring harness going up to the front of the car. All I did was remount this up. This used to be mounted down about here. I moved it up to give me space to put the cables in there and enough room to get the shield on there. Up at front, I did the same thing. I just took drilled some holes through the firewall, put some PVC tube in there, and just cleaned them up with a little bit of a JB weld. On the other side of the car, I've mounted my Evanetics speed controller. This one turned out to be a little bit of an effort. What I've got here is this manually pushes the throttle down. It's extremely smooth. I just did away with the pull cable. I didn't like it. The only thing I had to do a little bit is I had to turn the electrical connector around on this so it goes into the firewall. So I drilled a hole in the firewall and I bring the cable up. And interestingly, I bring the cable right back through the tube that normally carried the accelerator cable. So now the electrical cable runs back down through there, goes all the way back to the rear of the car, and I get a nice Faraday shield. The reason I had to turn the connector around is when you push the brake in, I didn't want the brake to interfere with the Evanetics pot. I'll probably put a little bit of a sheet metal cover over it, but that's going to be an extremely smooth. I know you can't really tell, but this is extremely smooth. The throttle pedal is in the exact location as the original car would have been. So very pleased with that. Let's see. Up front, I've mounted my charger. I've got a relatively small charger in this car. This is only a 2,500 watt charger. So it'll probably put about, 16, 17, 18 amps into the battery pack when it's on 220 volt. Got a Meanwell power supply. This is this will take 72 volts to 144 volts and convert that to 12 volts DC. It'll provide up to 40 amps. Still haven't decided where I'm gonna mount that. May mount it up here against the firewall or maybe behind the charger on the firewall, or maybe I'll just mount it over in this area here a little bit. Really not sure exactly where I'm going to put that. Got a few other items to mount up here. This is the PLC that will actually be controlling the logic in the car. Got a nice 800 amp shunt. This will provide 50 millivolts at 800 amps. This is a little pack transducer. It'll convert 150 volts, 0 to 150 volts into a 0 to 10 volts. That'll feed directly into this analog input card on this controller, so I'll know exactly what the pack voltage is. It'll be very accurate, probably accurate to a hundredth of a volt. This is a 24 volt power supply. This will be mounted again somewhere up in the firewall area. This provides 24 volts for the PLC that's going to be in the car, and it'll also provide 24 volts for my touchscreen display that's going to be mounted in the dash. So Just needed, I have to have, wind up have to have two buses in this car. Brought the cables in the front. When they come through the firewall, I made a couple of nice standoffs. They're just machined. I machined these on the CNC mill so they would take the profile of the cables, three cables stacked up. And I got nice clearance. There's room up under the cables so it doesn't hit anything. They're suspended in the air. It even goes around nicely. It doesn't touch anything. And the way the cables are made, they really can't touch anything other than the supports I've got on them. And then, of course, I bring them up through the front with three gland nuts. This is the cable that will connect the rear pack to the front pack. This is the most positive part of the rear pack. This is the most negative part of the front pack. So the battery pack that's in this area will be the most negative. Mounted my switch up in the corner of the firewall here, so that it's accessible in the glove compartment. I kind of like that, so you can just reach in, turn the car on or off inside the glove box when you're inside the car. I think that'll be kind of handy. Got my J1772 mounted. Don't know if you can see this good, but it's mounted here on the car, and this is the place where the original gas filler was. I'm going to make a polished aluminum cap for it. So you'll put the cap on there, you'll turn it, and it'll lock on these two flanges, and it'll pilot on the diameter of the nylon piece in the middle. The nice thing about that is it'll be fully weather sealed. It'll look just like a gas cap and be actually functional. Coming through, you got the standard wiring. Haven't terminated it yet, but the wiring will terminate with the J1772 connector from David Kernzel. I'll probably mount it on the firewall, probably in this area somewhere, just nice and convenient where the wires come in. I will be going to use these bus bars. I'll have one for the most positive pack, one for the most negative pack up here. I'll probably mount them, thinking right now, in this area here for the most positive, and mount the other one over here for the most negative. Haven't quite decided yet. It's just a little bit of a work in progress. And that's kind of where I'm at. I've got the car sanded down, painted, done some body work, repaired all the rust. As you can see, the dash is currently taken apart, so got a little bit of wiring to do, got everything cleaned up. If anybody wants to see how I did the battery packs in the front, I thought I'd show you. I wound up needing to put 16 cells up front. This is actually the bottom of the old gas tank that was in the car. I actually cut the top off of it, refinished it, painted. I made this box, so this box will hold 6 cells, and believe it or not, it does clear the hood. It doesn't really look like it, but there's about an inch clearance between the top of the box and the hood. The other box is in the front here. This one will hold 10 cells, so you got your 16 cell count up front. I took a little different approach than Jack does. Jack's theory is you paint it black, it disappears. What I did is painted everything body color. So all my boxes are painted with automotive paint to a pretty glossy finish. Sadly enough, the battery boxes are probably a little bit better finished than the car is. But I thought you might want to see how I arrange the batteries in the front.
Well, that's about it. Hope you enjoyed the update. If you want to find some more information about the car, I'd like for you to visit my website. It's called evthing.me. It has a lot more information about the details of fabrication of the car. And I'd love it if you'd stop by. Hope to see everybody at EVCon 2013.
Jeff sets pretty high mark.
That's going to be a nice looking vehicle. He's the attention to detail, huh?
What can we do that's dramatic enough to stay in the game, big guy?
We've got to just cinch up our defense, huh? We're going in.
I've called in the big guns. Sebastian Bourgeois.
Yeah.
Evnetics and Rebirth Auto. Let's see what he's done to me this week.
All right, let's look.
We're in the front of the Thingster.
Yeah, the Thingus.
The Thingus Among Us.
Yes.
Just an idea. Jeff Southern sent a video this week. And,
cool.
I stole an idea from him blatantly, and I'm prone to do that, particularly if they're good ones.
Those are good ideas, exactly.
and that is put our maintenance switch right here in this bulkhead, and the round part of it protrudes into, it's not a glove box, it's a glove shelf.
Yeah, kind of a shelf, yeah.
In like the dash.
Chart shelf.
Yes, the chart shelf. And so we'll do our connections. Of course, we're gonna put our Brusa up here. This is gonna be a 334 volt pack of CA60s.
Right, 60s.
100 of them. And so that'll lend itself very well to the Brusa NLG513 that we got from the Azure Dynamics auction. If you recall, Brian, the first charger I ever picked is one of my favorites, and that was on the original Speedster.
Right.
And
right.
We did use a Brusa charger.
Uh-huh. Yep.
They're OEM quality, really high quality.
They are.
Devices. Now, the ones we have are for high voltage. We're going to be doing a lot more high voltage when you get into the Siemens.
Yes.
And
yes,
I got
we
like
will.
50 of them or 48 of them in the liquidation auction. They'll only do about 11 amps, but on a 60 amp hour cell, that's
that's not bad.
Less than a 5.5 hour
yeah.
Charge. And so they'll be ideal for this. Right here is our gas cap. And we have already disconnected that. And we're going to put our J1772 charge port there.
Right in there, yeah.
David Kurzel's aluminum billet charge port.
I like that one.
And those Brusa chargers, we got them originally for about $3,000.
About those $3,000 with the first one we bought, I think. It, yeah.
And then the euro changed.
Yeah.
And Victor kept bumping the price up till they were close to $4,000 yes. for one of these chargers.
Yeah.
And at that point, I'm losing interest in a 3,000 watt charger. I don't care if it's, gilt edge.
It better gold be gold plated.
Cubic zirconium encrusted.
Cubic zirconium encrusted. We picked up those at Azure Dynamics. We're selling them for $19.95.
Yeah, that's nice. That's a nice price.
And that's a pretty good price. I did actually get some interest in from Brusa in selling them.
Oh, really?
Yeah, initially they were kind of snooty about it, but when they saw what I was doing, they decided maybe they would do that.
Okay.
But they wanted $2,700 for them in quantities.
For your cost?
20, I think. Yeah, my cost.
Oh, that's crazy.
I said, I don't think we need them that bad.
No.
We're going to put our effort in the TCCH chargers.
Right.
And they'll go up to 410 volts. Initially, I'm getting some 168s and some 258s.
Okay.
168s will do like 30 amps. 258s will do like 22 amps.
That's not bad.
I mean, it's the same thing. As you
go
up
as
in
you
voltage,
go up, it's going to drop the amperage.
For the same power, though.
Right.
But we can do their 4,000 watts, their 4 kilowatts, all come in about 4,500 watts, really.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Same Chinese thing.
Yeah.
You know, kind
over-deliver
of,
a little? Yeah.
Under-promise and over-deliver. So.
Cool.
But we will use a Brusa here, and the charger will be right here, and here's our J1772, and we'll have a couple of bus bars up here, and our DC to DC converter, and we got our two battery boxes, and like I said, Jeff painted black, that'll disappear. He's actually got a nice paint job on his. His was going to be prettier, but mine will be more noticeable. He's cream, I'm a violet yellow.
Yeah, we're violent yellow.
And but we'll have the Brusa here, and that'll be our maintenance cutoff switch.
Yeah, that's nice. I like the location.
Which I'll be able to reach from the driver's seat, and I always like that.
Yeah, that's nice.
I can't always do it, but I always like it.
Yeah, very nice.
So. There we go. What else did we do? Well, let's take a look at the interior. We can show you the switch and the accelerator.
Okay, good deal.
From this side, I don't know if you can see, but we have mounted our standard one each, and we use these quite a bit. It's a Chinese Hall Effect three-wire accelerator. It has a 5-volt source and a return. And it does a Hall Effect pickup on the signal line. I like those because there's no resistive contact to wear out and get little glitches in it. And we've had good success with those. And so we've got it mounted kind of on a bracket there to the firewall where the pedal sits, right where the pedal on the thing was, but it comes down from the top, and that'll work very well. And that's our accelerator. It's simply Shane made a L-angle bracket and bolted it to it, and the pedal you can put on either side and at any position. It's like on a knurled axle, and so however you mount it, you can usually arrange the pedal pretty closely. But he got that very close to the brake, where I can step on the brake and think I'm braking and really be on the accelerator. No, he's got it in a good position right about where the accelerator was, and we'll be able to get good pedal action on that. Let me show you the switch in the glove box. Okay, I don't know if you can see it, but here is our Blue C on-off switch, our maintenance switch there in this, I wouldn't say a glove compartment, but a glove shelf above the stereo, and an easy reach from the driving position. Right back here behind the back seats, we have a new box. It's aluminum right now, and we have not primed or sprayed it with a rocket, but we're going to. It's just the right size to have two CA60s side by side, and we can have them 22 cells long to the point where this angle flattens out on this shelf behind the rear seats. And I've got it to where the rear seat and the roll bar are quite compatico there. And so what we'll do is paint that and then bolt it down onto this steel base, and that'll hold it very securely. That'll hold 44 cells. Now we've got 36 in the front big box and 20 across the front for 56. And we put 44 here, and we will have 100 CA60 FI cells that will do 10C, that's 600 amps. And I would say that in almost all cases, I can't imagine really going over 250 or 300 amps on those cells. They'll do 10C, but I tell you, you can get a lot better life out of your cells if you limit them to about 2 to 3C on average load. This controller and motor, I could see 300 amperes at 330 volts with the CA cells, very little sag, much less sag than the Johnson Control Saft experiences in the Azur Dynamics. These Chinese cells are really a lot better than what our OEMs are using here in the United States. They don't know it. I don't know why, and it's not my place to correct them. And so, but this will give us 100 cells, 334 volts. We'll have a 600 amp capacity for a drivetrain that couldn't possibly use more than about 300 amps in any instance I can imagine. And that's a good sizing. It'll also give us a 60 amps by 334 volts, let's say 320 volts nominal at 60 is 19.2 kilowatt hours. And on a vehicle like this, I would expect 250 to 300 watt hours per mile. And so we'll have pretty good range. It won't be a 100-mile car. And the way I see using this car, it wouldn't need to be, but 70 or 80 miles. And that'll be fine. And so that's our third battery box, and we're kind of done. These CA60 cells stack real nice because they're pretty small. Reno, we're in the ass end of the world.
We are. Look where we are. We've worked our way all the way around.
The thing is, rumpus.
Thing is rumpus.
You know, it looks like almost like that motor would just almost clear. When we put those batteries in there, this is going to squat down a little bit. We got a problem.
Yeah, it's going to sitting right on it, isn't it?
Yeah. So we're going to have to cut out, you know, a pretty good chunk of this. So I see you've removed the rear bumper, and that's okay. We can put that back on some extenders or something.
Yeah, we might extend the bumper, yeah.
A couple of our viewers have suggested a, you know, like that Toyota FJ Cruiser?
Yeah.
It's got a hard shell spare tire
carrier. Looks like a spare tire carrier, yeah.
Yeah, we could do something like that.
Okay.
I don't really care if it sort of looks a little electric car-ish out the back end.
Yeah.
We got a couple problems. Here's our rod to hold open our door.
Yeah.
And of course, this is our latch to hold it closed.
Right. We got a little wiring too going across. And,
what I was thinking was, this might look a little goofy, but like, you know, in some of the speedsters, they put those leather belts.
Yeah, we can do something like that.
Something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, they've got those. They've got those straps too, like on a Jeep or something. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We can hold
something
it closed.
Like that. But you're going to have to cut out a pretty good chunk here. About here to here.
A freshly painted thing.
A freshly painted thing is going to have to drop to the concrete.
I know.
And, of course, we'll lose our latch. There's a little bit of wiring. I think you can work that around somehow.
Try put in a little conduit or something or wrap
well,
it.
Well, you might have to lengthen it and bring it around,
yeah.
But
I think we can do it.
And we're going to kind of, if you notice, avoid the battery boxes that Jeff did, and we'll have plenty of room back here. I guess we'll mount the DMOC, if we can, to this or this.
Okay.
Where it's up here.
Up on top, yeah.
And a short run to the, our terminals for the motor.
Right to the motor.
And that, you know, and we'll have room on the two sides to put peripheral thing. We're going to have a pump and a derolly underneath.
A fill bottle. Yeah.
That sort of thing. So we're going to leave this kind of open for drivetrain type stuff and our cooling system.
Yeah.
And so I think that'll work pretty well. But unfortunately, we're going to hatch it, the bottom anyway, of our thing. And it may actually get to...
Yeah, I don't know if it's going to hit. I was thinking about that. It's going to hit the top of our door.
Yeah, we may actually lose a notch out of our door. which would be interesting. But I don't have any help for it. I'm excited about the Siemens motor. I want to get it into a build. I think this would be the easiest place to put it, where we can put it in, take it out, put it in, take it out, put it in, take it out.
And it's our current project.
And it's our, well,
I mean,
our current
project, VW.
Because I wanted to put a Siemens motor
right,
in.
Right, that's right.
This is all part of God's plan.
That's right. It's all working, man.
It all works together. But this will be our kind of rolling test bench for the generalized electric vehicle control unit
right.
That will run that DMOC 645 and hence the Siemens motor, which thanks to Sebastian, I think we're on just a dead bolt on. We've already got a throw out bearing on there, don't we? And it's all greased up. Great.
Yeah, we do. Yeah, there's all your throw out bearing.
And so we literally, with this gone, are bolting that thing
just
up.
Just slide
up,
it in.
And we're there.
Yeah.
And so this is shaping up as one of the easier builds I think we've ever done. So there must be something wrong with the strategy. Something's going to go wrong.
Right. Something's going
to
go wrong.
This is pretty major, having to chop off part of your car. But,
yeah.
You know, after your work on the Nippon, I'll let you and Shane noodle over how to make it look attractive on the back. Whatever you come up with, I'll love.
Okay, we'll do it.
It's don't go to extreme measures. Even if it's sticking out in public view, I'm not sure that hurts me.
Yeah, but people like electric cars. They
like
to see stuff.
Electric car.
Yeah.
And so we'll put a ribbon on it or something, a little carnation or, you know.
Yeah, don't touch EVTV test.
Bobblehead doll on top of it or something.
A Mizzou tiger tail, something.
Mizzou tiger tail, exactly. Now you're thinking. So. And so it'll be a little whimsical, but I think it'll make actually a pretty easy build. I think this one's going to fall down on us so quick that it's...
It's going to happen fast. Cool.
Yeah. It's like 100 cells to bottom balance. but 60 amp hours, they bottom out pretty
quick. Not quite the work of some 180s.
It's not like sucking 180s down to nothing. And so that's where we're at on the VW thing. Stay with us. It's going to be our first Siemens project. Brainiac.
Hey, here we are.
What do we got here?
You know, some of these pieces, I am not quite sure. What did you manage to amass here in my absence?
This is kind of an interesting story. This is, of course, our Siemens motor with its little stubby spline shaft. What is that, 26 spline? It's only about an inch long. And a bigger shaft that's shouldered.
Yeah.
And we want to put it in a VW thing.
Oh, yeah. The thing project.
You know who I think makes the best adapters in the game?
No.
Sebastian Bourgeois at Rebirth Auto, Evnetics.
Yeah, right. We love those guys.
I talked to him. Of course, we do VW transaxles all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Well, he does too. He says it's about 10 to 1 VW.
Really?
To everything else.
Really? That's a nice conversion.
Yeah, it is. So I had him, I sent him a motor. And I asked him to take a look at doing an adapter. And he did an adapter and a coupler and a thrust bearing in one fell swoop.
Nice.
It has a thrust bearing right here. And this accommodates the shoulder
on the
main shaft.
Yeah.
And it has splines for the spline shaft. And this bolts right to the Siemens motor. And if you turn it around, it fits right on a VW transaxle. But better, he's got the hub for a VW with the four pins.
Got the flange with the dowels and the whole thing. Yeah.
And the threads for the gland nut.
Nice. Nice.
Now, assuming any of this fits, and he didn't actually put it on a transmission, as it turns out.
Are we going to find out?
We're going to find out. He does a lot of solid works with CNC stuff. That's why this comes to me so easily. This motor to vehicle adapter is probably one of the more difficult challenges I find in doing an electric car. And it's my belief that we would have a lot more viewers and a lot more people interested in doing builds if it was easier.
To put an adapter together is what you're saying.
Well, to put an electric car together.
Electric car, okay.
We've got the batteries pretty much down. And really, it's not that hard. I mean, an electric car is inherently simpler. We have a battery that provides power, and you have to have a charger to recharge it.
Right.
And then you have a motor that turns the wheels with the battery current, and you have to have something where you can control that with the accelerator. So it's not one speed all the time.
Right.
So you can go faster and slower. And we call that a controller or an inverter in the case of an AC. But it takes driver controls, the turning on the ignition switch, the putting it in gear, the accelerator and the brake, and runs the motor. And beyond that, we're down to a DC to DC converter.
Yeah, right. Just that 12 volt.
Converts the pack voltage to 12 volt to run the rest of the stuff in the car.
Right.
What else is there in an electric car?
It just depends if you have any other systems, but a basic electric car, you've really outlined it, you know, beyond that, environmentals or
after
something.
That,
if you have
that, you're working on your heating and your air conditioning, and there's a million strategies, you know, from using the stuff that's in there to doing something else. The basic, to make a basic electric car, you have a pack and a charger. And you have a controller and a motor.
Right.
And then this fifth thing out there is a DC to DC converter, which everyone kind of understands. It makes 12 volts for your headlights and stuff. So what's the hard part about the electric car? There's some wiring between your sensors, like your accelerator and your brake and so forth, and the controller.
Right.
Some little things like fuses and switches.
Yeah, contactor here
and
there.
Safety things, an inertia switch. But the one that always gets me, because I'm not very mechanically inclined, is the adapter. And that's usually a coupler to couple your shaft somehow to the transmission,
right,
and an adapter to mount it. And then sometimes you have motor mounts. But in the case of the VW transaxle, you don't. In fact, you don't want to mount it to the car because the transaxle is separately sprung from the car body. So we kind of hang them off that transmission.
Yeah.
And so there you have it. I asked Seb to do this historically because of some things a year ago. I bought 10 of his Solitons and bet him I could sell them in a few months. And I did, which was instead of him advertising, I sold his Solitons,
kept the money. That's right. In lieu of advertising.
Thinking that he would get it, that he would have made more money selling the Solitons and giving me my little cut for an ad. But no, he liked that. In fact, he wanted me to buy 10 of these.
Oh, there we go.
So we'll feature them in the store. But he's done a remarkable job. This is not cast. This is machined billet aluminum with a thrust bearing and exactly what you need for a VW flywheel on this side and exactly what you need, complete to the shoulder for this big shaft and the splines that fits right on the motor. And so for about 4 inches, you're done.
Yeah.
And
it's nice.
In the past, we have bought adapters and didn't really like them. We've had Lucian make them a lot.
Right.
Usually takes him 3 tries. and we're waving arms, trying to figure out why it doesn't work, and measuring and then changing, and it just gets to be a big deal and an expensive deal. I think I'm gonna charge $2,200 for these. I've started with a lot of $1,200 adapters and wound up with that much in it anyway.
In it anyway, yeah. We've had the famous $10,000 adapter.
Yeah.
there was two.
We spent a bundle on the Mini Cooper. This is a very cunning design, and it's not my design. I simply mailed him a motor and said I wanted it to work with a VW transaxle, and he did it from there. They do a lot of VW transaxle adapters. So the trick was, and he got this done somewhere outside, this piece that has the splines and the threads for the VW blend nut.
Nice, yeah.
And there we are. We have it, and we're going to put it in the thing. The one drawback on it is our motor's a little longer than what we usually use.
Yes.
And this costs us another 4 inches.
Yeah.
The package is 22 inches long, clearing the hoses.
Yeah.
And, of course, you got the hoses in the back of the car.
Right.
And, in fact, our electrical connections are mostly in the back here. So it's going to be a long piece. We're going to have to...
Yeah, 22 is long.
22 inches is pretty long.
Yeah,
so
for what we've done.
That's something you want to check. But this, I believe, would make a great and very powerful package. I think you could, with the right controller, get this up to 150 kilowatts in a light sand rail.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, hill climb, sand rails. Drag cars, some race cars, that'd be fun.
Yeah,
it'd be a blast.
It'd tear some stuff up.
Yeah, that's right.
And
you could work all week fixing the parts you broke.
Yes, you could. This would be a liquid-cooled 150-kilowatt motor, I believe you could do some damage with. So I think it's going to be a neat package. We're going to do something else, and that is he's going to do another adapter for us to connect the AC50 or AC75 to an e-gear drive.
Oh, okay. Could we do a DC as
sure.
well?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, here's the problem. We don't have a reverse gear in the e-gear drive, and reversing electric motors,
DC series motors,
is a little bit of an issue.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
But, it can be done.
Yeah, but it is. You're right. It's an issue.
So the e-gear drive works better with AC motors that you can very easily reverse.
Just flip a switch and reverse, yeah.
So that's that. But this will let us put a Siemens on any VW swing axle or IRS axle. Now, this is VW from, what, 61 to 79, something like that?
Yeah, I mean, you could go probably back even a little further, yeah. This gives you a wide latitude, this adapter and the VW transaxle.
Not
with the new ones, no,
or
yeah.
Anything like that, or the new Beetle.
Really the air-cooled.
Yeah, the air-cooled Beetles.
Yeah.
And so we have a thing. This will be perfect for it.
Nice.
Have you figured out how to put it all together?
Yeah, it actually doesn't seem that difficult. Before we start, and we're going to start with a Torx here. We've got 8 bolts here on the faceplate. We're going to remove 4 of these bolts.
This is holding the faceplate on the motor.
On the motor, yeah. We're gonna move.
So just take out every other one.
Yeah, just take out every other one is what we're going to do. I'm going to get them loose, and then we'll take them out by hand.
I'm not sure we can reach them by hand, pardon.
Oh, well, I'm going to get them with this. And then I'm going to need an extension, like a short, maybe like a 2-inch extension or something. Okay, so we'll just pop these out of here.
Is this the same thing or different size?
That is a socket. Yeah, it's a regular old socket. So we're going to pop these out of here. And we have never taken these off, so I don't know what they look like, but they're nice little bolts. Go. Cool. Thanks. Need that later. Forgot the tool. So we're just going to remove every other one.
Let me see one of those.
Yeah, sure. There you go.
Oh, that's nice. Full thread.
Yeah, that's first thing I've ever taken off this motor. It's actually a nice little bolt.
And they had a little thread locker on the end.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So now we have every other one of these bolts out.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So in the adapter, now the next step is actually to fit the adapter up. And there is a notch up here, which gives us the top of the adapter.
Okay. That's a little bit important. These look regularly spaced. The two bolts here are 3/4 inch right. Wider than these.
And they don't look it at all.
That's the mounting bolts for the VW transmission.
Yeah.
And if you look at them, they don't look.
They look symmetrical.
Right.
Yeah.
This is up, and that's kind of important.
Okay, so now we're going to fit this, our splines and our shoulder side up here. There we go. Okay. So now that's up.
And the big trick there is just to get the splines lined up.
To get the splines lined up.
Very close fit.
Just 20-some splines, yeah, and it's really close tolerance.
Mm-hmm.
So we're up with the top now.
Okay.
And we do like to use thread locker. So we're going to use thread locker on all these bolts. And the first one we're going to do are
these. But we're not going to use the regular bolts. We got longer bolts.
We're going to go back in now with longer bolts through this faceplate.
Okay. So because of the distance, this bolt's not going to make it, but we got some shoulder bolts, and I like these black hardened oxide hex head things.
Yeah, those are nice.
Seb picked those out,
and I think he did too, because they're recessed, mm-hmm. and that gives they'll be able to go inside the head, so they'll never they would never interfere. There's some threads, and we're just going to replace. I'll make sure that I got them all. I don't remember which ones I took out. Every other bolt. Okay, you got that thread locker there, Jack?
Mm-hmm.
Cool, thanks. I'll give you a little. There you go.
Alrighty.
So we'll just pop those in.
A little Permatex thread lock.
Just to be safe.
Maybe here.
Yeah. This is where we need the extension. Now we're good.
Now these aren't Torx, are they?
These are just Allen.
Okay. Well, I've got a little wrench here.
Yeah, we got another Allen wrench too. Just make sure that's on there good. And this is the sequence here that Rebirth Auto has come up with here. So we're following the sequence, so you'll see this as they've described it. Okay. We've got those in now, hand tight. Now, they are, we have our torque wrench set at 19 foot-pounds, and that's what they have recommended here. And we'll just crisscross, and we won't all the way torque it yet. It's always best to torque in a star pattern. If you've been watching the show a long time, you've seen us do this before. There we go, and you hear the click in this type of torque wrench. And then we'll go back. Well, we don't lose our bit. Go back here. And there we go.
There it is.
My wrist used to do that right at 19 foot-pounds.
But yes.
It doesn't anymore. It does it at about 12 right now.
Well, we're getting older.
I know.
Anything over 12,
yeah, that's
nine
right
for
yeah,
me.
Yeah, that's right. I can't do it anymore by hand. Yeah, let's see. Oops.
Keeps it eating your bit.
Yeah, it just gets stuck in there. And this will be our last one here. Okay. So we've got all those torqued down. Now, the next thing that they are describing, there are these bolts right here, Jack,
the
big half-inch bolts that are going to come in now from behind, and we're going to do the same thing with those.
Now he's actually got a serrated
lock washer there, yeah.
Washer. I think I've got an extra. Anyway, what do we put the dome side up?
Put the dome side, yeah, dome side up.
And then
They'll come, and then a flat washer, and then they'll little Loctite, and then they will come up from behind.
Cool. Got four big holes.
Yeah.
On the side of this.
Loctite here, and we'll be. Well, that didn't look right. I was going to have an extra washer. And we'll get these in, and then these we're going to torque. Recommended is to 40, and I'm going to actually need to get that wrench. That's something I forgot. Let's see if we have one. You may have to do this by hand. I don't know if we go up that high. I don't know if we go to.
Yeah, well, let's just torque this down.
Yeah, I don't think we have a 12.
Allen wrench.
I don't think we have an Allen wrench big enough. We'll torque this down after, but you guys get the idea. These go to 40 foot-pounds. I gotta hold on that for you. Okay. I like the quality of the parts.
Man, it's just like a piece of jewelry, Brian.
It really is.
And it just fits on there perfectly. And now, and remember with our compression fitting.
Oh, yeah.
We're always trying to check the flatness of the flywheel and stuff. This is kind of already done.
It really is.
We don't have to really fool with that.
No, this is really nice.
It's going to be okay if he's square in the thrust bearing.
Okay, so we've got that. Let's make sure we haven't done this before. Okay. Let's go ahead and show them this, because this is on a VW is always interesting. These are the studs, and these are where we're going to bolt our motor up to the adapter plate. And these were bolts previously in a VW. Mm-hmm. One of these studs is longer, and that stud goes on this side right here.
Where the starter is.
And when you're looking at the car, it's on the passenger side. When you're looking at it like this, it's on this side, where its motor's going to be flipped around.
Right.
So we're going to go ahead and put these in.
So we're putting on studs. These will poke through the transmission. You've seen us use bolts for this in the past. In this case, we're going to run studs into the adapter.
And we're just going to run them down. Let's see.
These are the nuts.
Do a short side. That would be those nuts we would use to bolt it in.
Oh.
So we know what I'm going to do. I just put the wrong one in now. Yeah. Go like this.
Yeah, put the short end in.
Put the short end in. So on the threads here, there is a long set of series of threads and a short series, and I just put it in the wrong way. So as long as you catch it, I guess, huh?
Yeah.
And then it's going to take those to the bottom of the threads. These are the same here. So you're okay on the shorter ones. Just on the longer one, just be aware that the threads are shorter on one side than the other. Actually, I checked these. We don't have to tighten them in.
Oh, you don't?
Yeah, we're okay. We're just going to put the bottom of the threads. And you may have to, you know, once you get this in the transmission, you may find that you're going to have to take them out a little bit. So just be patient.
I guess that's right. The way this is, if you tighten this nut on the end, it tightens it in.
It tightens it in. It's going to pull it in. Yeah.
And if you unloosen it and it comes loose at the adapter, well, pull it out.
You're right. Doesn't matter.
Yeah. That'll work.
Yeah. I was worried about bringing them down, and I'm not even going to put them completely in so that we show some thread here. Okay. So that's that. Now we've got, at this point, we need to be able to put the flywheel on. So we have done that in a crisscross. All right, so we're going to install our flywheel. Now, there is something about VW flywheels, and you may not be able to see it here, but there's 8 dowel pins. And 2 of the dowel pins are spaced a little further apart, and 1 is closer. It's also on your dowel pin here on your crank flange. So we have to find that so that it fits on there. Don't force it at all, because you will be able to find it.
If you line them up right, it just sort of...
It'll just drop on, but it'll seem like you've got them, and you'll have 3 of them, and you won't have 1 of them, and you will damage your at least your dowel pins and maybe your flywheel. Okay. We've got a rubber mallet here somewhere. And Evnetics also suggests that we do not use the big bolt that we're going to put here, the gland nut that we're going to show you next. Use it to bring the flywheel on, because it could damage the threads. Mm-hmm. So we're just going to go ahead and...
Now, have you got your 4 pins lined up right?
Yeah. Yes. We've got a flashlight. Let's check.
Seated, yeah.
Yeah, now we're seated. Okay. So that was what, again, Evnetics, and that is true, not... If you don't use the threads to draw things up.
I always do.
I know, Jack always does. Don't try that at home.
That way, if I've got the pins on wrong, it just bends them.
Just bends them. Now, we've got a flywheel lock.
I see why
lock.
You're putting the bolts now.
Yeah, we've got a flywheel lock here, because we're going to end up torquing this little guy. Let's see if all of this will work.
Does it maybe have a long side and a short side?
It does, and we need the short side for a 200 millimeter flywheel, and this long side does not work. I may have to take one of these threads out and use the bolt. We do have a bolt too. So this will keep the flywheel from rotating.
This is like an additional little tool, but I guess Jeff Southern turn me on to those.
Yeah, it's good. It's good to have a flywheel lock.
They're not expensive.
Oh, then just a few, but there we go. We'll just thread this in enough here to get it locked on. And you just position it where it'll hold the flywheel. Okay, now we are going to first make sure that we've done everything. We're going to check everything that Seb has given us here. Yeah, we got it. Okay, so we have got VW gland nut.
Mm-hmm.
And a VW gland nut is not only a big bolt, it's not actually, it's not a nut at all, but it's just called a gland nut. And don't use the big high performance ones ever. That you always want to use the ones in this, these applications that have the 36 millimeter head. We tried using on our very first conversion, one of the big ones, and we wouldn't clear the clutch.
Yeah, that's right.
So don't ever get the big one. And then there's a thrust washer here, and it will cover all of your dowel pins so that they can't come flying out of there at any point in time with RPM. So, and this does not get Loctited on. What it also has in here is it has needle bearings.
Transmission pilot?
Yeah, so that when the pilot comes in, it sits in the needle bearings, and that will support the input shaft to the transmission.
Mm-hmm.
And we will just put that on. Okay, now we've got our lock in here. We've got this. There is a recommended torque spec, 254 pounds, Seb. Just suggest you run it up with a impact set to max.
The only thing we've got is 254 pounds.
With 100 pounds. So let's just get that set and just pop that on. See if that's rotating anymore.
And what do you call that socket, a 36 millimeter?
This is a 36 millimeter, yeah, and we're using a nice impact socket, a nice thick-walled socket.
Uh-huh. So 36 millimeters, working on VW stuff, that's kind of a cool thing.
Yeah, it's good to have that socket, that 36 millimeter impact socket. And you can get them like this, too.
Uh-huh.
When you're using an impact, sometimes you can shear off the wall. So if you have one laying around, that's fine. If you want to buy a regular socket, that'll work too.
You know what I think that is? That's my water heater socket.
Is that what it is?
Yeah, it's the same size for your electric water heater elements.
That's funny.
Yeah.
Anything that'll work. So, I'm just going to clean this up a little bit. Get all this blue off of there. Okay, so now we have.
And we used to always have to fool with runouts.
With runouts, so this looks really
good.
This
is just precision stuff. There's no runout, no runout issues. It's just get her down tight on that coupler that Sebastian built in there.
That's nice.
And there we go. We're already into the car. This comes with a car, a flywheel.
Right, exactly. And we do have our pressure plate,
mm-hmm.
And we can go ahead and show them how this all works.
Mm-hmm. What kind of clutch you got there?
You know, I don't know what we bought. Do you know?
Just a stock.
A stock, because we got a stock pressure plate and a stock disc here.
You know,
looks fine to me.
And with that much power, we might want to do something later. I tell you what, I like smoking clutches a lot better than snapping axles.
Right.
Yeah. It's if you're, you know, kind of overdriving your clutch a little bit, if you want to get into a racing situation, you might want a stage four Kennedy or something. For my use with the VW thing, what we want is for the clutch to slip instead of snapping.
Instead of snapping some axles. Yeah. Or
yeah.
Some shear off some gears or something.
Yeah. All right. So we've got a pretty good Rancho 344 transmission, but if something's going to give, I'd like it to be the clutch.
Be the clutch.
The clutch is the expendable item.
Right.
You can change clutches. They're not very expensive.
Let me check this.
They don't do other damage very much, and so I'd rather have the clutch go at this point with our experimental.
Because we don't know what the heck's going to happen.
And we'll have it where we can drop this motor pretty easily and put another
clutch.
Yeah,
if we need to, yeah.
If we want to take it racing or something.
So this is our disc, and the disc on a VW, as you can see, one side does have the standoff and a little flange. The other side's flat. The flat side is the side that goes toward the flywheel.
Mm-hmm.
We do have one of the VW pilot tools, and we use that when we did the Cobra and some other things. It's just nice to have it. It centers.
It's a plastic tool to center it.
Centers the disc.
It takes a little investment. I think it's $4, but you can always put it on a credit card and pay it off over time.
That's right. Probably won't be able to get that.
And it's just the sort of thing that you keep, and you know right where it is until you need it, and then it's somewhere in the shop.
So we're going to do the same thing. There's six, and these are actually VW pressure plate bolts, and I would suggest that you get them. They're, besides that they look cool, they're what you're supposed to have. So we go, and let's see, I guess.
Particular direction?
No, just, I got to go up and a little toward me. There we go.
I always have trouble getting these started.
Yeah, there we go. Get that one in. Let's get another one here. A little toward me here. Yeah. Actually, I like the way that one went in. Put another one. I'm going to go back to that other one. I don't know if it. There is. We do have cross-threading issues sometimes at EVTV.
Mm-hmm. That's usually if I thread it. I'm holding and you're threading. This should work out
pretty
good.
That should be okay.
And yeah, this little tool makes it a lot easier. We're not trying to.
Yeah, not trying to approximate the where that goes.
Yeah.
And in fact, a little extension over there, Jack.
An extension? I do not.
What did I do with it?
I've got a little.
I've got it here somewhere. I did have. There it is.
2-inch
extension. Here it is. This should help me. Yeah, there we go. Okay. That was in danger, possibly, of a little cross-threaded situation. Uh-huh. And one last one, and then we're going to reset our torque wrench to 18 foot-pounds is the suggested for a Volkswagen. And we're going to do them we'll get these just snugged up enough to where we're not on the pressure plate yet. We're just on the disc. And again, we'll just use a little star pattern here. Because we're going to want to bring this straight on.
I'm going to put these nuts and washers on here
so I
know where they're at when we put them in the car.
So we know where they are when we lose them.
Yeah. That's exactly right. So we know where they're at when we lose them.
Okay, so I'm just going to use this, and I'm just going to do a star pattern, and I'm not going to torque this yet.
This would have been a good time to still have that
flywheel lock.
Flywheel lock on there.
It's a good time to put. Actually, it's not a bad idea.
Same old problem.
Yeah. But we know how to fix that. It's our trusty flywheel lock. There we go. Good call. All right. So we'll just go ahead and run these.
A
little bit by hand.
Yeah.
Once you feel a little bit of tension on it, then go ahead, go across. We just want to get this on nice and flat.
Flat and square.
Yeah. Yeah, and when you go back to them the next time, they'll be easy to do, and once they get a little bit of tension on them, they go to the next one. Now we're starting to feel some little bit of resistance. I can read the numbers on the torque wrench, we'll be able to get this to 18 pounds. And we're starting to get close to the bottom here. At this point, we're going to run it down and not put any torque on it. There we go.
Well, I'm glad you're getting done with that. This is such a boring video. I'm starting to doze
off. You finally see what I was talking about. All right, so we're going to put this 18. All right, and this is going to take care of it. Again, just use the same star pattern. There we go. There's one.
One clicky.
Two. Three. Four. Five. Six. I'm just going to make sure we got it. All right. I think that we are. We can yank that. Yep.
Viola.
And we'll pull our pilot tool.
Our clutch is in there.
Let me put our
Viola.
Let me put our thing back here, our stud. I've ripped out of there twice. Not a whole lot of drama, but a lot of fun.
It is. I'm pretty taken with this. This is a very
nice operation.
Professional,
really nice
precision
setup.
Thing. It's easy to put together. It's very precise. I think we're going to get a good fit on this. And so the problem we're going to have is it's 22 inches long.
Yes.
And from the face of the transmission, we're going to have to do a little body work on our thing. But I think it's going to be okay. This will be a very, this is going to be an exciting thing. Ed Clausen is coming Sunday.
Oh, really? Oh, good.
To meet with me. He's working on the shield for the Arduino Dewey.
Right.
And we're going to plow ahead with the...
For the vehicle control unit, right?
Yes, yeah. Indeed. And we're kind of taking a leap of faith here. I'm installing a motor and having an adapter made, actually having 10 adapters made. These will be in the store for $21.95 or something. But if you want to make Siemens motor to a VW transmission, it doesn't get any easier than this. We're going to thread these into the transmission holes, put these nuts on it, tighten those down.
That's it.
Make sure the pilot goes right into that little needle bearing thing, and we're mated up to the car. And like I say, this is one of those things that if you watch on YouTube or the guy's doing a garage, a car in a garage, all the machining and stuff that they have to do to marry an electric motor to a transmission is arduous and tedious.
and not very interesting.
No, it's
to me.
Really not. Some of us like it. No, yeah, it's not.
I like it about this. Yeah, about this. This is about how much effort I want to put
this
in.
This is cool, though. It went together really nice.
And we bolted up, and it's just like having a flat four in a VW.
I've
just
real cool.
Mated the motor, and how much simpler than the flat four this little square motor is.
Yeah, you can put a jack under this thing. It's nice and flat and everything. Just jack it up and
put a jack put under it, put my cup of coffee on top of it while we're installing.
Yeah, just pop it in.
And so I think that'll be, but when you consider what you take out, that internal combustion engine, and what we put in, even with a couple of cooling hoses on the back.
Yeah, and some connections.
Three-phase connections or encoder connection here. Yeah. It's trivial. This is to change an engine, to change a motor in this thing, not would that, be an hour.
Yeah, not that big a deal.
I mean, it's just not that hard. If the motor should last a million miles, but if it doesn't,
so what?
Swapping it out is sure. not a huge deal.
No.
I did find a guy. I'm going to put his contact information in the forums. Named Tim Francis, I think, with Delta Motors in California.
Okay.
And he is emerging as the go-to guy to get your Siemens motor repaired.
Oh.
He makes his own seals because you can't get seals from Siemens.
Oh, geez.
He rewinds them. He says they put a bunch of stuff in here you don't need. He rips that out. He rewinds them better than they are. You know, he's got chased down the bearings. And everything, he called me because he really didn't have the encoder worked out yet. But fortunately, they don't fail that much. But he's worked out replacements for all the parts, and he rebuilds Siemens motors, usually for these guys with buses and the big ones.
Oh, yeah, the big motors, yeah.
He said, oh, yeah, he'd be able to do these, no problem.
Ah, cool. Okay.
And so this is a rebuildable motor, and I think it'll last a million miles, but if it didn't, the windings are much lighter than you find a series DC motor because it's a higher voltage, a lower current, you know, like 300 amps is what you'd put in here.
Yes.
Add up to 400 volts at 300 volts at 400 amps would be like the max. I could see, you know, up to 400 volts at 400 amps. We're having Reinhardt. They have a 150 kilowatt controller, and we've sent them a motor, and they're testing it. But I think this, with a good flow of coolant, I think you could do 150 kilowatts briefly.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
And
so that's a lot.
And certainly, the spec on it is, you know, at 120 kilowatts is 220 foot pounds. So you might be able to get up to about 250 foot pounds out of this thing, which is enough for any passenger car.
Probably, yeah, that's plenty.
With a transmission. So I've been excited about the motors from when our first opportunity to get them. But now we're starting to work into some applications where we can do some development work on adapters and so forth to meet them to projects that people might actually want to do. And so I'm not going to go full-time into the adapter business. Seb's done us. We're going to do two. We're going to do this one to make the Siemens to a VW, and then we're going to do C phase or whatever they call it, the net gain. ADC actually came up
with that pattern.
With that pattern, and then net gain had the same pattern, and then AC HPBS used it for their ACs. But what I see is the HPVS AC50 or AC75 with an e-gear drive as being a viable
pair. That could be nice. Yeah, I think so.
So we're going to do a little development like that, you know, in small 10-unit quantities. They're going to be a little less than, a little more than free. We're going to charge you for them. But it just makes it easy to bolt this together. And so you'll be able to do an electric car. By this time next year, I think I'll have it down pretty good where somebody could conceivably do an electric car in a day.
And that's all of a sudden we get a lot more conversions at that point, you know.
You sure would, if it was easier.
Yep, things get simpler, more kit formed, productized, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, at some point in an Evcon, we're gonna take a pretty basic VW type car and do it in a day.
Yeah. Be a blast. We've got a shop.
Yeah, we got a shop. So stay with us. I think this will make a great package. Good work, Sebastian Bourgeois.
Nice work,
Rebirth,
yes.
Rebirth Auto.
Yep, great.
And this thing bolts right up. We'll still want to check, make sure it hooks up to the transmission.
Right, just a little more checking.
Yep. Stay with us. One minor little change here, Brian. We get some very nice fittings with the Siemens. But as I said, we're going to have a little clearance problem in the back.
Yeah.
And the Siemens, if I can remove this little cap, terminates in a barb.
Oh, in a barb anyway.
But the barb, you got to put a hose. And after you put the hose, you have to put a hose clamp.
Hose clamp.
Hose clamps belong on washing machines, not in my electric car. I was molested by a hose clamp at a tender age on a 1954 Dodge.
You were traumatized for life.
And I've been traumatized for life. We don't use hose clamps for anything. What we use is Summit Racing AN fittings, Army Navy. What is that? It's like a 40-degree face or something. Yeah, it's different from a regular thing. Anyway, I have pulled these out. Machine did. I couldn't get them to come loose. They're potted in there with some putty, plumber's
compound. Yeah.
And but we got it loose and threaded in some nice a half inch NPT by AN6 terminals. I could see AN8 for this application, but with our little pump, we move a lot of fluid.
A lot of fluid, yeah.
Through an AN6.
Yeah.
And so going with AN6 on this. And then what we'll do is on our hoses, put these AN690s. And this is strictly a function of trying to reduce our show back here out the back end of the thing. So that'll go on there like that. We can, you know, have it anyway, but we'll have a black nylon hose that will fit onto these fittings. And these are pretty much leak proof.
Yeah, they're great.
You tighten these down. And the AN, you don't put, I put Teflon tape on the threads of this NPT,
right?
But the AN is sloped, and when you screw that down, you don't need any kind of compound or any Teflon tape or anything. And it forms a leak-proof fitting, as you've demonstrated in the past, putting the hose together. You get that hose clamped in there with those threads, and you're good. You can pull the hose apart before you can pull that fitting off the end.
It's true.
And so I like this, and they're always a little anodized. We get the black anodized Summit Racing fittings. They use them on hot rods and race cars and stuff. These are, I don't know, the elbows are $8 or $9.
They're
bucks.
A little more expensive than the straight ones, yeah.
The straight ones are $6. These are $8 or $9. And, but they'll, I like the black. It just looks better against the aluminum than this larger stuff, and it's sort of a quick disconnect. You can pop one of these things off just in a New York minute.
Yeah, I mean, just seconds. Threaded, yeah. Yep.
But it just makes it easy. A barb and a heater hose and a hose clamp on my Siemens 1PV5135 motor that I had to go to Livonia, Michigan to get. I'm gonna guess not.
Not really.
So we're going to use our Summit Racing thing.
That was easy to put together.
You know, it was.
That was, you know, of all the things that we've done, we didn't have to measure, but it really went together nice.
Yeah, and just it's reduced the whole process to almost trivial. And that's where we need to go with this, Brian. We got to make these cars not so hard, where they can focus on things that make them pretty,
right,
or make them special, or make them custom.
but not be wrestling with adapters.
Yeah, and not taking you know, a year or a year and a half to build it because you need to measure everything and do stuff. If you want to, that's fine. Yeah, making it more
plug. If you want to, do it somewhere where it shows. Who right. Who looks at your adapter?
No, they don't even know that it's there.
Right. Yeah. It's this is a no payoff effort.
Right. Yeah.
You know.
You get a plug and play option, we're good.
Sure. Put some prismatic paint on or
Yeah, nice wheels, whatever you
do
want.
Do the interior out of rare ostrich skin, pig skin, Chinese pig skin, whatever. But what's the payoff to doing a really good job on the adapter?
Yeah, none. You need one that works very well. But
you need one
it.
That works very well, and after that, you're done.
That's it.
So that's our motor thing. Let's take a look at some of the little things that we've gotten accomplished, kind of at a snail's pace, but the theme should be, and I'm convinced our viewership and our future and the future of this thing as a hobby and as an avocation is all about getting more people involved with it, and that really is a belief system that they can do it.
Right.
Which centers on making it a little more plug and play, and that's what we're about here. The motor, is almost light work. Mounting the D-Mock won't be something, and then we'll be where I wanted to be with this vehicle as a test bed for the generalized electric vehicle control unit, which Ed Clausen will be here Sunday to talk about.
Okay.
They're doing a shield for the Arduino Dewey, and we're moving to the Dewey for this project, largely. It's got a ARM Cortex M3 processor. What that is, ARM is kind of interesting, the evolution of these processors, and I've followed it for some time. ARM is the advanced RISC machine. Sort of a consortium. It was actually started by Apple Computer and Acorn Computer with a chip company that was quite famous back in the day, VLSI, very large scale integrations. And they devised this concept of having a simple but fast processors using a reduced instruction set, computing, RISC, in the process. The evolution of these things, they've now got huge instruction sets and have added so many features that actually the numbering system and the designation system for their processors just got to be berserk.
Okay.
But these processors go quickly to less than a buck a piece. And would you believe in 2010, they produced 20 billion of these processors.
Really? Oh, man.
20 billion multiprocessors for a planetary population of 7 billion. That's three for every man, woman, and child on the planet. So it's a lot of them. It's got to be a very complex product line. ARM doesn't make anything. They license their intellectual property. And TI makes them, and Atmel makes them, and everybody licensed this thing. M3 is the earliest of the Cortex line, which followed on the ARM 7 line, and got them into 32-bit, and so they have an instruction set that has 16-bit instructions, thumb, and 32-bit instructions, ARM, and then now thumb 2, which has them both. And it has more instructions than the non-RISC processors back when they started with it. So it's, but they're very capable chips, very powerful. The Arduino Dewey, we're talking 84 megahertz, 32-bit, dedicated hardware interrupts. It's a cool little chip.
Yeah, it's kind of serious, yeah, sure.
And so they're going to that. Ed is working on a shield that will let us do a 12-bit analog to digital for our brake transducer and our accelerator and so forth. Have four A to D inputs. Colin's already got the software working with two wire pedals that does the sanity check. And so we're coming along much quicker than I had imagined, but moving to a better platform. The Shield will also have Wi-Fi on it.
So
our configuration will be over Wi-Fi from any wireless laptop using an HDMI page.
That's nice.
And so simple. You don't need any software.
Right.
You can do it from your iPhone. You can do it from your iPad. You can do it from your laptop and Android, anything with a browser, basically. And so that'll work out very nicely, but it'll be 10 times the system that we were at with the Atmel 8-bit chips. And Ed's going to stop by Sunday and talk with me a little bit about that and throw around some last-minute ideas and wish lists for his Shield. And so, and we'll have two, it'll have the transceivers for the two built-in CAN bus channels that are in the Dewey processor, which I can't, it's a SAM something or other processor, but ARM Cortex M3 architecture. So that'll be cool. So we've done the thing.
Done a thing. We did a little work on the Speedster this week.
Yeah, let's take a look at the Speedster. That's coming up for delivery, and it's looking pretty good. Brano, what do we got going here?
Well, we needed to finish off the front compartment here of the Speedster Nippon, and we had, you know, the gaping hole that shows us the front suspension, and
you know,
we
need
to cover it up.
Your fitment is going to make some for some really boring video.
I know.
They're not going to believe that wasn't always that way.
No.
It looks so perfect that it looks like obviously wasn't that the way it was.
You know,
it was
today?
Not. We had a big hole where the gas tank was, and you could see out the wheel well.
Well, you could.
That's and it was black, so it didn't look too bad. But we've added some ABS hair cell sheet, a little backing on it to make it stiff.
Yeah, we've got a nice, real stiff backing here, yep.
And we've got it cut out for a little TCCH charger. I like that charger mounting so much better than the other Speedster Dub.
We had the Speedster Dub, and you have the bigger charger. This is nice.
It is. This, in Speedster Dub, is in the back in a very awkward place on a very flimsy sort of panel.
Well,
I mean, it worked, but this is much more solid. If you plug in up here, you got to have the hood open. You can't really drive away.
Right.
With it plugged in.
That's a big deal.
Of course, we had our rocket bed liner on this front box.
I like that stuff. I've never seen that before. I've seen bed liner, but that is cool. I like the use of that.
We just spray that, and it comes out that black with that pattern.
Yeah, I like that.
You do have to put a primer on it.
Yeah, I noticed
that.
We've
got an acid primer. Jesse was decided he knew better and did this front box without the primer because he was sure I was just, you know,
you didn't have
entertaining
to
people. He came in the next morning, he's in tears. This had slid off the aluminum and was laying like a piece of vinyl.
Just like a piece
on the
of
floor.
Rubber or
it
something.
Just slid off the box.
Jesus.
Aluminum is, you have to etch it or preferably you sand it. We use an acid primer, sand it again, and then hit it with whatever you're going to paint.
Yeah.
I don't really do all the sanding because the aluminum's kind of roughed up anyway by the time we get done kicking it out.
That's right.
I'll wipe it down with lacquer. Get the grease off of it.
Yeah.
Put a coat of that acid primer on it and let it dry, and we hit it with that rocket. But this is a much neater conversion than the other car we gave them.
I like this one, yeah.
We've got three battery boxes. I mean, you remember, like, Professor Gadget had the whole front end covered in batteries, sort of bare.
Right,
We've got two saddle boxes in the back that are completely enclosed, have lids on them, and they're black with rocket. They kind of
do disappear.
You can hardly see them.
They do.
And I made him one show box
for show,
up
it's
here.
Nice to have. People like to see the cells. Yeah.
But we got polycarbonate over it, 3/8 of an inch. You can't get through it.
No, that's nice.
To get to the cells. And so you can take a jacket off and throw it in here. Probably a briefcase up front. I mean, this is not going to haul your golf clubs, but a little storage. All of it's safe. The plug-in, the charger. It just looks like somebody did this on purpose. But you did such a good job on this that we got... This is like boring video.
I know. Sorry, guys. Everybody, and it's black.
Everybody's going to look at it and say, well, what else?
Yeah, that's right.
You know, I mean, it looks like it probably was always that way, right?
Looks like we did it on purpose.
Yeah. No, it wasn't always that way. It was kind of a... It's got a curved front, and but you've got that fitment thing down to an art. It just... it looks like a manufactured car.
No, oh, thanks. And, at least this part. This part I did.
Yeah, the part you did.
We're no, getting good at this.
Well, we got our electric speedster emblem on the sides. We got dash gauges with their name on it. Delta Force is the group in Tokyo.
It really is cool.
And so I kind of have to break it to them gently that I just don't picture us in the car building business.
Man,
they have the design,
work,
but
yeah.
Particularly with this licensing, you talked to the state of Missouri.
We got the VIN number has arrived in Poplar Bluff. He did find out. It takes 2 days to get it down there. So this week we should be able. And he can't make an appointment until he actually has it in his hand.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So hopefully this upcoming week. It's Friday today, so next week would be the week of the.
And then we got to send that off to get the title. Then we can register.
He sends the paperwork in for the title.
Okay.
Yes. And then they'll release the title. Yes.
And so sometime in the spring, or.
And we don't even know what year.
It's what is today? 21st, 22nd.
Today's the 22nd.
22nd of March. It's not spring here.
No, it's worse.
February was warmer than March.
I know we're 3 days in the spring, so who can tell?
Yeah, no kidding. I was thinking 22nd of March was the vernal equinox.
It was 2 days ago.
Really?
On the 20th? Yeah.
Okay. Well, I felt about...
You knew. You were right.
About halfway
right.
Between...
Yeah, that's right. You're kind of straddling winter and spring.
Summer solstice and winter solstice.
Yeah, we're close.
So, no, it looks great. I guess we're going to finish this car. It's probably the best... one we've ever built.
I really
did like the ivory one, but they wanted a red sports car, so I got one.
It's a nice color red, too. I like it.
It is a nice red,
yeah.
But I sure like that ivory one. That was kind of my daily driver.
Yeah, you know. It was.
So, oh well. Electric cars, they come, they go.
And they go-go.
And they go-go. Okay, Sam, we're getting this one ready. You know, I told you November the 1st, I think we're going to make it this
year. I think we'll make it, yeah.
Stay with us.
All righty.
So, I said years ago, if we would just do a speedster every year, after a certain serial number of years, we're going to get good at it.
Yep, getting better.
That's a factory-looking car, Brian.
It's a nice-looking car, yeah. Everybody's worked on it, done a really, really nice job.
You can't see a wire in it.
No.
You can't really see a battery except under the polycarbonate.
Right. And then the people like to see the batteries every now and then. Could show them. Yeah, it's a beautiful car.
The speaking of batteries, I've got a project I've been working on with some Chinese guys to make me an extruded silicone rubber device. I'm going to call this a cell booty, and it came in today.
Are we going to have to look at your cell booty?
You're going to have to check out my cell booty. Take a look here. Racing thing. I have something I've been working on for a long time.
Oh, all right, cool.
And it's one of those super simple things that's been very annoying. This is a very simple piece of silicone rubber, quite dense. It insulates, of course, I wanted it to be dark blue. It came out light blue. I'll have to talk to him.
Oh, okay.
It's extruded. This comes out of a machine that puts this in liquid form, and it comes out of a form that shape and shoots it out of there.
Kind of like a pasta maker or something.
It's got a blade that chops them off in 1 meter lengths. I've been working with a company in China for 6 months on this. And they've actually made four molds.
Oh, really? Had to make
You got to make the dies. You got to make the tool that fits in the extruder to get whatever shape you want to come out of this thing. And this uses, you know, they do weather stripping for windows and stuff. This uses quite a bit of material. I wanted this special silicone foam rubber. It's very dense, and it has a temperature of 350 degrees centigrade that it will withstand. So they would make the mold. When it would come out, when it would cool, this would splay apart.
Oh, man.
And we'd get different shapes as it dried. So we kept changing the shape of the mold until it's actually kind of 45 degrees in like this. But when it comes out, it spreads, and it's just like that.
It allows for it,
These are very careful measurements that I made. What we wind up with here is a shoulder that's just about the size of the terminals bolts on the, you know, the big nuts on the batteries for the SE or the CA. And then there's another shoulder, which is just about the width of our battery strap.
Okay.
And then that's recessed just enough to get the terminal heads. So I can lay this down over the straps, and it just kind of sits on them, and the feet go all the way to the battery. So I've got something, you know, I can pound on, I can set a board on, I can set my coffee cup on that. I've got this, these two batteries in parallel. Don't try this in series.
We almost did. And we're professionals.
Don't ask me how I know.
And we're professionals.
Don't try this at home. But this is going to be the EVTV cell booties. Now, they'll lay on there, and they even kind of grip the straps a little bit. But what I would advocate, and we'll probably ship them with these, is a little 6-inch zip tie that you slide under the strap and cinch that baby down.
And you have a
perfectly touch-safe battery terminal, but it's real easy to take it off and do stuff with the terminals. And so I've put a lot of thought into this. What would be insulating, inexpensive, and that would be easy to put on and take off.
Yeah, and work.
Now, I've got this cut into strips two batteries wide. I wouldn't do that. We'll sell this in meter lengths, and you'll cut it where it'll have a strap here. Now, on the next cell, it won't have. On the next cell, it will have. And this will just lay along your line of batteries, and you'll have one on each side. And so you can put a board or something on top of it, or a lid. I mean, there's a lot of things that we already do after that. Let's see if I can cut that. And you could secure them with these zip ties, but it fits over the strap, the terminal bolts, the nut on the cell, and it's shouldered in there where it accommodates all that and doesn't move around much, and then you can put stuff on top of it. Of course, if you drop a wrench in your battery pack, nothing. It just bounces.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
Just get it on the rebound. Yeah.
And so to make your cells touch safe, and, you know, we worked a lot of different castings and stuff to go over the big cells on the truck.
Yeah, we did
and
a lot.
I was thinking of doing them this length to just go over this, and then you would alternate them. I wouldn't do that at this point. What we've gone to, instead of casting a one bridge thing, is gone to an extrusion
These two are cut off of here. These will be at 1 meter lengths. And you just run them until, and then butt the next one up against it.
And that really makes them safe. I mean, you can't work anything then inside. I mean, that's really good.
No.
Yeah,
and,
but it's nice.
You know, it's not going to trap moisture in there and cause corrosion or anything. It breathes, it's insulating, it's soft, but it's firm enough. And that this was part of the thing, was to find a material. This is not sponge rubber or foam rubber, or it's a silicone urethane foam that's actually quite dense. I mean, it's got a little give to it, but not much, really.
Right.
And of course, it insulates. It's fire resistant to 350 degrees, and it'll let you set up your cells where they're safe. But you can still pull
still
it off
get to
and
them,
take
yeah.
a look at it.
Yeah.
I mean, it'll really, if you have a length of it going along the length of batteries, it kind of gets hung up in the battery strap and the Nordlock and all that. And so I'm going to call them the cell booties, EVTV cell booties. And I really...
Cell booty call?
Cell booty call, yeah. Cell booties. And you just put them over these straps. And once you have it on both sides, you can actually set something on here, a board
right.
or
You're
something,
fine.
And
yeah.
a piece of plastic
nice.
Or whatever. And even stack cells. This way, I mean, you could put a metal box on top
on
of this
top of it, yeah,
and do another layer, because they're very good at insulating, and but I don't think they'll have any adverse effect on our straps and so forth. Of course, you BMS guys that have wires going everywhere, I guess this would work around them, but it's not my problem. We don't do that. We don't advise it, and so. I've been in a group called Battery Pros or something on LinkedIn,
yes,
and they're all
yeah.
pontificating over the Boeing 787, and with all kinds of bizarre theories. And I dropped in this, well, what if you're just overcharging the cell because you've got it above the cell voltage? Oh my God, they went crazy.
Oh, did they?
Yeah, and
they're running everywhere, bouncing
off the
walls.
Is the ones that design BMSs, and so they. Were trying to explain to me how their BMS worked, and then I had to explain to them how it really doesn't do what you think it does. Here's what's really going on, and it's upset a lot of apple carts.
They haven't kicked you out yet.
And, well, they're on the verge. On the verge. They're pretty much going to run me out of that before it's all over. I'm going to keep after them until they
until they do though. That's right.
That
yeah.
But on the topic of the 787, we've already. Going on and on about that. I'm pretty confident of my analysis of that. I'm a little frightened that they're going to publish a fix. The FAA is going to sign off on it. They're going to go back in the air, and they never solved the problem.
Just put it in a container.
Well, you know, they might accidentally solve it.
Okay.
One of the things they're going to do is charge to a lower voltage.
Oh.
Well, if they do that enough... then the state
it
of charge
not
will be down low enough.
Right.
Of course, like I said, it takes some energy to start the turbine.
Yeah.
If they don't run it too long on the APU then. I mean, it took many, one of the reasons I know I'm right is it took many months for this to show up. And then we had two fires within 1 week.
Yeah. They got some time on the APU. On the APUs. And
roughly the same amount of time on the APU. There's only so many ways you fly an airplane. When you're talking about over 9 months or a year, no problems, pop, pop.
Yeah, all of a sudden.
In 7 days.
Yeah, right.
The 9th and the 16th of January. I know what's happened. And they were just overcharging it, but not very much. And it's sort of a creeping thing. It's the damage is creeping and cumulative and irreversible. And,
yeah, you get a closed system at that point, yeah.
And so they're just overcharging a little bit each time. Well, if they would drop the state of charge down, what's they're talking about doing? I think
give
they're
them
going
more room,
to accidentally cure it and never know what the problem
right,
was.
Right. They're going to give themselves
the
a little overhead. Yeah.
But meanwhile, they're going to outlaw perfectly innocent batteries as freight in the air and on the ground even.
And so that's that sort of sucks. I mean, it's the usual thing. The inmates taking over the asylum. Meanwhile, we keep plodding along, and I keep doing goofy things like this. It'd be an embarrassment to me. You know what it is, Brian? I figured out why I know this stuff. I was talking to my wife last night. I would be willing, aside from starting with the Chinese documentation,
yeah,
which I've added to our website, by the way, your glad acceptance is our warmest happiness.
Yes, that's right.
Highest service, highest quality. Kalb, cost of less bill. Aside from that, I'm sure the only battery guy in the country that actually has a hole in his bedroom floor where one of the batteries melted through the floor.
The one you had to throw out the window.
And I had to throw out over the balcony into the snow pile in the driveway.
Into the snow, that's right.
How many of them have done that?
Yeah, that's right. None.
Now, you've been around here, you're kind of a nerd to it, but imagine if we were working in a corporation and I was a professional battery engineer and my boss came in and saw, I don't know, what do you think, $20,000 worth of burnt-up batteries littering the place in every room, in every corner.
Desk, the floor.
How long before they asked me to leave?
You wouldn't last long.
Benches right. Burnt through with the battery fall through to the floor.
With the slag hanging over the edge.
Fires that spring up 6 days after I've overcharged.
Yeah.
Brand new $1,000 4-cell packs that I... forgot, left charge.
Left charge a little bit, yep.
And Trace came in the next morning. Your garage is going to burn down. It's melted.
The garage.
Help me, I've melted.
Help me, I'm melting.
Oh, what a world. What a wonderful world. These guys can't have that experience because they would be fired.
Yeah, that's right. They wouldn't last. They wouldn't fit in the corporate type.
No. Yeah. They would just tell them to get their stuff and get out of there. So I've had a lot more opportunity to screw up batteries than anybody this side of Secura Plane who did burn down a factory. Now, I haven't done that
yet. Yes, we haven't done that. We're trying, though.
They burnt down a whole factory. So I'm not entirely on solid ground here.
Right.
But I think I probably, more than anyone, a battery engineer in the world, have got more battery deaths.
That's right. Burned up more batteries.
Notches on my gun.
No, that's right.
Than yeah. anybody, because if I was working anywhere, I'd be unemployed.
True. Yeah. Yeah, you just wouldn't work. Sorry, Jack. It's just not working out.
The basic difference between them and me.
I always wanted to say that, by the way.
They get paid to do this, and I have to pay to do it.
That's right. Handsomely.
And by the way, it's one of those smoking batteries is my Ducats.
That's right. That's right.
So it's not just that I burned them up. I felt in my heart of hearts the pain they were going through in flames. I was going through in the pocketbook.
Right.
We're simpatico. The battery's in agony. I'm in agony.
That's right.
Okay?
You're feeling it, man.
I'm feeling Vulcan it in my heart,
meld.
Right here next to my heart.
That's right. Vulcan wallet meld.
Yeah, right. The Vulcan wallet meld. That's right. Perfect.
Oh,
I mean, stop and think about it. Who else is doing that?
Yeah, nobody. No, nobody should be. Anyway.
Nobody would be allowed
nobody
to.
Would
They'd be
allowed.
Asked to get their desk cleared out and go home.
They bring in security and a couple of file boxes.
There's nobody here got enough sense to fire me.
Oh, man.
So here we are.
Yep, we're doing
I
it.
I keep plugging away. It's completely obvious to me what's going on, and they struggle with it. And then they get caught up in their own hubris. This poor Juca BMS designer has gone on record as, oh, no, that's not going to be it. So now he's hoisted on his own petard.
Right, now what does he do?
He can't listen to anything. He can't learn anything. Mm-hmm. He's calcified.
That's right.
It's the end of his career. To deal with these cells, you have to be able to learn every day.
Right.
And they change them.
That's right. They get a little different.
These are not the cells that we got from Sky Energy.
No. No.
They're different. And if you can no longer learn because of your own personal hubris, you're done.
Yeah, you'd have to be doing the same thing over and over again. That's pretty boring.
So anyway, this is a stupid little innovation, but I've had to go back and forth 4 times. These Chinese guys get different tools cut to do this extrusion
of this, and it's a fascinating process the way they make this. And this is all done by email and pictures and drawings back and forth. And this company, they don't have any obligation for any quantity. I don't even
really
know how much they're going to cost. And they've cut four knives for me for this extrusion machine. I think they've gotten caught up in the
whole process of doing it.
The project.
Yeah, right. And the whole,
and they do know about batteries. They're in China.
Yeah.
This is my personal patentable design.
Sure.
Guess what'll show up on Alibaba.
Yeah, that's right. On Alibaba. Yeah.
But.
Yeah, let's file a patent.
Well, we will. It'll be as good as the paper it's printed on.
Yeah. But what the heck?
Say we have one.
We have one, that's right.
Yeah, we'll file one. But, yeah, this is the Rickard Cell Booty. And but I think it's just going to be a cool thing to put on top of your batteries. It just fits on there. And it pretty much stays in place. I would probably, you know, tie them on with a zip tie or something on two or three places in the whole pack, you know, but they'll stay in position and you can then put stuff on top, and it's a little bit spongy, but quite firm. It'll hold weight, and it's a good amount of insulation, fire resistant, easy to put on, easy to take off to get to your cell terminals and tighten them or measure them or whatever you want to do. And plop them back down on there.
I like it.
So it's kind of a big piece of spaghetti.
Yeah. Last time I saw something like that, it was hanging on the wall in an adult bookstore.
But I think it's cool, and they just got here today.
I like
it. So you guys see them the first shot here in the state, so I'm kind of proud of them. We're not going to have them for a month.
It'll be a little while, yeah.
I have to put in an order for them now. We have to have a big argument about how much they are because they went to all this trouble and so forth. So they'll probably be stupidly expensive. But don't forget our internet price match guarantee. If you find a higher price anyway, where?
We'll match it.
We'll match it. I do have some guys who were... like they're shopping me on the batteries and going and getting them somewhere else, and then they come to me with all the advice, the straps, the goodies. We're going to start doing this. You get them if you buy batteries.
There you go. We'll put you in a database.
We're not going to sell these separately. I don't have time for these super shopper clowns. They're kind of missing the whole point of this. If we work together, we can get to OEM quality stuff that's easier to put together and makes a better car. If you want to grub around in the lawn for quarters, there's guys out there to take care of that.
Sure.
And you're going to wind up least common denominator with electric junk. And that's, you know, what you deserve if that's your main mode. I think we can get to OEM quality components at the prices the OEMs are paying if we demonstrate some purchase
power. Some buying power. That's right.
And yeah. So that's what I'm about these days, is to get you better stuff cheaper, and but
not cheap stuff.
Yeah, you'll be able to beat my price, I'm pretty sure, on any particular piece of goofy hardware along the way, if that's your mission. So anyway, I'm kind of giddy that these are finally in. They are pretty much the dimensions I gave them. And I wanted a darker blue, but I can get darker blue.
Yeah, that's a solvable issue.
Once we get this working there, we're talking about the dye they put in it.
Yep, that's right. How much pigment? Yeah, exactly.
But with the gray cells, I think dark blue would look cool. But I'm very pleased with what I couldn't get, of course, by email, is what it feels like, the density of the foam.
Right,
and
right.
It has to be dense enough to stand up. See, on the next set, there's not even going to be straps.
Right.
It'll be alternate, you know, straps.
Right, alternate straps, yeah.
And so this has to be able to go down the line and stand up and, you know, kind of hold things off. And it feels really good to me right now.
Good.
Now I know what it feels like. I could make it harder or softer, because we've got a reference.
Now you got a reference, yeah.
But I like this the way it is. We'll make it darker blue, get it 1 meter lengths, and you know, I guess I'll probably have to buy a 10 Brazilian.
I have a million. And, they'll be everywhere.
See, that's the problem. It's all over the world. Everybody wants to sell, but they really only want to sell 10 Brazilian of them. They don't want to sell one or 10. So that's what's going on there. But I thought I would share that, and we'll do some close-ups of this so you can see kind of exactly how it fits over that. It actually is right at the top of the terminal, and the bottom is hitting. And so there's not really going to be any splay. It's going to, the terminal bolts are going to hold it almost exactly. And the straps fit, and then it goes out around the nuts on the top of the batteries.
Yep, and I like so it.
I had to draw this about 10 times.
And your art skills haven't been very good since second grade.
No, I was not the cool kid in the art class, so that's been a problem. Let's see what else we got going on.
All right, we'll move on.
That's pretty cool, actually.
I've done a lot of work, measuring and fitting and so forth, and then going back and forth with them, and we had some problems. You know, it comes out of the extruder, it cools, and it would spread, and I'd have too much material up here and not enough down here. And so we've been back and forth on this 4 times. It's a real simple thing. It's just a piece of silicone foam rubber, but you can put it over your terminals. And now throw a wrench at it. I don't care.
Right, then the whole.
It's, you know, just to make them safe.
Big deal.
It is. Yeah. Well, it's just we're constantly having to be so careful. I drop a pair of glasses down in one of these battery boxes, and it just goes crazy. And just I wanted something simple that hopefully will not be too expensive. That is simple to put in. You can take it right back out and play with your cells and tighten them and do all these stuff and put it right back on. Maybe I'll secure them a little bit with some tiny zip ties under the strap, but
other than that,
it's not very elegant, but it's simple, insulating, good to 350 degrees. I like it. And I just got the first one today. So it's going to be a while before I've got it in the store because we've got to order them and they got to beat me up on price and all that stuff. And so I'd like it in a darker blue.
I bet they can do that.
You know, I'm thinking so.
I think so.
So I got an email today I wanted to share with you. You remember Fred Baining?
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah.
He did a bug eye spray.
And he brought it out to the EVCon 2011.
And then he came back with a MGTD and got best paint in the show. He sold the bug eye spray.
Oh, really?
To a guy named Barry Garibrandt. I got this today. Hello, Jack. My name is Byron Garibrandt. I'm Barry's son. I'm very sad to report that my father passed away last Friday due to complications of surgery. I know that he was planning to return a converter to you, and I plan to do that when I can. I did receive the replacement. He wanted a little different one. We went ahead and sent it to him. I think we kind of trusted him to send this one back. I thought you might like to know that he really enjoyed your videos and the work you have done. For the last few years, he had been watching and learning from you and would often share with me your latest lessons. You were a hero of his. When he retired last May, he finally decided to dive into an electric car project, part of my 100,000-man army.
Yeah.
He purchased Fred Benin's e-bug eye electric sprite roller. Fred had taken a lot of his components out of there. Partially because he used to own a Sprite in the late 60s. He started designing the wiring schematic, and I was fortunate to work with him with that. He was a retired electrical engineer who worked with satellites, and he enjoyed bringing his aerospace
knowledge to this new endeavor. His plan was to have it and to be solar charged. I do intend to complete the e-bug eye and at least to the level he had planned. Although I wished we could have many more years working on this project, I'm very happy that he was at least was able to get the e-bug eye far enough along to drive it around the block on the weekend before he passed. I'm sure he would have liked to, and perhaps he did, but on his behalf, I want to thank you for the work you do with EVTV. It truly was an inspiration to him, Brian Garibrandt.
Oh, that's a touching letter.
Isn't it?
Yeah, that really is.
One of our soldiers has fallen.
Oh, man.
We're going to have to, you know, set up a wall or something for our lost soldiers.
You have a moment at the show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, Brian, thanks for sharing that with us.
Absolutely.
And I'm glad he got an EV grin before he passed. It seems like that's mostly what we do these days at this age is bury our elders. Mm. I've been doing quite a bit of it myself. It's more fun than I make it look like. Actually, it's not as much fun as I make it look like.
Yeah, I know.
Anyway, that was an interesting letter.
Very, very nice.
And so we covered the battery straps, the motor, again, thank you, Sebastian Bourgeois.
Yeah, very nice.
Going to make me buy 10 of those things. I got to send him a check, I guess, before we go home today. But he's going to take on the task of mating like an AC50 to the e-gear drive.
That's what you're saying,
yeah. You could use a net gain or a DC motor, but the e-gear drive doesn't have a reverse. So you have to reverse with the motor somehow. And that kind of limits it to some degree. But people that do direct drive have to do that anyway with the serial motors.
Yeah, right.
And so, we always use a transmission, just use reverse and transmission. AC motors, you just flip a switch and you reverse. In fact, you can swap any two leads and you're in reverse. Yeah. And so they don't have that issue. So I think AC70 on an e-gear drive be pretty low cost, pretty high torque, and it's got about a 300 newton meter peak, 200 newton meter continuous on the e-gear drive, and that's about as much torque as that thing will handle. The AC75 would do that.
Okay, nice.
And so, he's going to tackle that for us next, but then they want me to buy 10 of them, I'm afraid. This all started with the battery straps. That's how all this started. See, I only needed 57 battery straps. The guy makes me buy like 5,000 of them. That's how we got into this component same thing. And now UPS owns me.
Yeah, I know.
They're in there. I think one of those guys has got his own desk in here now. It's crazy.
That's good for us.
UPS, oops. Anyway, we appreciate your support. Via the component sales, it's given us a little oxygen, and we can continue the process. And we're kind of, in a way, getting involved in product development with this sort of thing and the adapters and so forth, and trying to stand in as a kind of a co-op buy to some of these big companies, the Borg Warners, the Siemens. We're talking to UQM and Reinhardt. Mm-hmm. And of course, we'll show up at all the liquidation auctions. Coda coming up, Fisker, on your behalf. My goal here is to get them the OEM components at about what the OEMs are paying for them.
Right.
Instead of at five times thing. You got to work with me here. Part of the issue is product support. So we have to have forums and, I get the documentation and get a little bit smart on it, but then we kind of have to have a different expectation of support and the information and so forth available online for people who want to use this device, so that these companies are not burdened by
support.
And that's part of their objection to selling you their stuff. And so over and over you see they're selling them to the automakers for $5,000. If you call, it's 35 or 25 or something stupid. Many didn't pay $25,000 a piece to AC propulsion for those things. Coda didn't pay $34,000 to UQM for those. The car was $32,000. That's your first clue.
Right, that's a clue.
And it had enough batteries to go 130 miles.
Right.
And so this has been this horrible game. But there are some legitimate issues, and selling one is not a very satisfying experience, particularly if it's somebody that you would maybe sell them another one in 3 years.
Right.
And number two is the product support issue is very real. We're hoping to kind of, working with you and you working with us, work all that out to where some of these companies become more willing to part with the good jewelry and the good components.
Yep, get us some glory.
And you know, you talk about a Siemens motor and an e-gear drive from BorgWarner, that's pretty good stuff. If we could do a AC75 with an e-gear drive, or in this case, a Siemens motor with a, and I gotta tell you, I'm really blown away by Sebastian's adapter.
It was
the minimum space you can occupy and still get that spline shaft, and even the shouldering on it, and that land nut thing, I expected for that to bottom out, and we're not even, it was perfect.
Yeah, it was beautiful.
And the flywheel spun totally, truly. It's on a thrust bearing. It's billet aluminum, not cast. That thing will last a bazillion miles.
Yeah, that's the only one you're ever going to have to buy.
It's the only one you're ever going to have to buy. I mean, that's just not a failure item. And so I was really blown away with that. But we're bridged now to any VW transaxle with essentially 150 kilowatt liquid cooled AC motor.
Yeah, that's pretty serious.
That is built like a tank.
Yeah, that's pretty serious.
And so good week. Good
Absolutely.
Week. We have our EU warehouse is expanding and getting a very good reception in Europe. At this point, the Kalb isn't going to have, they don't have now, a warehouse with batteries on hand in Europe. And Anna is putting down a pretty serious investment in about 50,000 amp hours, 400 or 500 cells that you can get on a truck in the morning.
Yep, that's right. Put it on a lorry.
And the VAT and the customs and the shipping and all that's already, it's in there.
It's done. It's on the price. You know what you're getting. It's great.
Europe's kind of tough on cars, but he's working boats.
Yeah.
And see, they don't have all those things. And I mean, he's going to have boats gliding silently around in Amsterham in the canals.
Are they
going to
make them make noise?
No, they're not going to make them make noise. Maybe a little horn. Toot, toot.
A little boat noise.
Make boat noise. Paco Bell Cannon and D, up to 18 mile per hour.
There we go.
Over here, we'll be able to play Basil Poledoris, theme from Lonesome Dove. We'll bring music to the world. We do appreciate Byron, your dad, and all our viewers who, it's a distinct privilege that you would take that kind of time out of your life to watch us rattle around on this harebrained mission to convert the world, Pinky, to electric drive. I was always going to do it. We're just going to do it. And So you can tune in every week and watch us win or watch us lose or watch us do something. That's our mission. I need 100,000 of you to go into a garage and sweep out a space about the size of a car, and we can change the world. And you can take that for whatever you think it sounds like. I'm serious about it. And I'll work your ass to death doing it. But that's where we're going.